is a complete idiot. Her recount campaign has nothing to do with electoral integrity. It's a vicious assault on the very bedrock of democracy itself.
This is not being done to benefit one candidate at the expense of the other.
Really? Is that why all the recounts are taking place only in states that Trump won? Why not a single recount in a blue state that Hillary narrowly won? Jill, Trump won Pennsylvania by 78,000 votes, while Clinton won New Hampshire by less than 3,000 votes. She won Minnesota by less than 44,000 votes and Nevada by around 26,000 votes. Smaller margins than Trump won Pennsylvania in every case. Why no recount in any of those states? Why a recount in Michigan, which doesn't even use electronic voting machines? None of their systems are even connected to the internet. Both Stein and Hillary Clinton's campaign admit they have no proof whatsoever of any fraud. But Jill's only doing this because she really cares about democracy. In fact, Jill cares so much about democracy that she spent the last few days fawning over someone who spent his entire life sending democracy activists to gulags.
Fidel Castro was a symbol of the struggle for justice in the shadow of empire. Presente.
So you're calling for electoral integrity while praising a dictator who ruled for half a century without a proper election.
Americans deserve fair, transparent elections.
You're saying Americans deserve fair, transparent elections while genuflecting over someone who presided over a one-party state for 50 years. Give me a break. Hey, Jill, Cuba's last election seemed a little bit fishy. How about a recount there? And while you're at it, why don't you audit California and find out how many illegal aliens voted for Hillary? That's not going to happen, is it, Jill? Because this has nothing to do with electoral integrity. It's about you remaining relevant, having failed to get barely 1% of the vote. It's about you fooling people into giving you a ton of money for something disguised as a recount, which when you read the fine print actually says the surplus money is going straight into the Green Party's back pocket. It's about you trying to regain lefty street cred by doing Hillary's dirty work for her. It's about the left trying to delegitimize Trump's presidency before it even begins by stripping him of his Electoral College margin of victory, forcing Congress to directly select Trump. So all the butthurt, "Hillary won the popular vote" morons can go out and riot again, full of contrived righteous indignation. Unless they engage in brazen fraud, Trump is still going to be president. But given that the recounts probably won't even be done in time, they're going to use this to disrupt the Electoral College vote before December 19th. Oh, and isn't it just rich that the raised corpse of Hillary, "only people who hate democracy challenge election results," Clinton, is now hovering in the background of all this. Maybe November Hillary should have listened to October Hillary.
To say you won't respect the results of the election, that is a direct threat to our democracy. Look, some people are sore losers and, you know, we just gotta keep going.
The same hag who lectured us about being sore losers refused to even concede to Trump on election night until Obama basically forced her to. She also reneged on a deal with Trump to concede within 15 minutes of the Associated Press announcing the winner. Now George Soros, globalist despot, who specializes in overthrowing democratically elected governments, has been connected to the recount campaign. Well, imagine my shock. Listen, don't think that just because Trump won the presidency, they're actually going to let him become president without a fight. The political elite don't play by the rules. The rioting, hateful, butthurt, intolerant left are their attack dogs. They're perfectly willing to trash democracy when the result doesn't go their way. Look at Brexit. Nearly 6 months later, they're still doing everything to sabotage it. Between now and January, we have a massive battle on our hands. Listen up, Jill. We know you have complete contempt for democracy. We know you're bought and paid for by Team Hillary. We know you're a lying piece of Why not just admit the real reasons for all this and stop pretending it's about electoral integrity while you simultaneously praise dictators who once imprisoned and killed those who actually fought for electoral integrity? Take your George Soros money, go back to being a political failure, and stop being used as a pawn to overturn the democratic will of the American people.
Well done, Paul Watson. Well done.
All the latest straight ahead on this Tuesday edition.
And here's the latest from the Communist News Network, their latest fake news.
Biggest racist, misogynists feel legitimized and justified by this election, which is why, you know, I hope that Donald Trump does much more to lower the temperature. When you, this election was like boiling water. When you put water to boil and the thing starts to bubble, once you turn off the stove, it still takes a long time for that water to go back to being room temperature. Anything and everything that Donald Trump can do to get us back to room temperature, to get us back to a more civil area, he should be doing. And that includes not tweeting out, not tweeting angry tweets against Jeff Saloni, our colleague, or CNN, or Hamilton cast, or whatever. You know what I mean? Look, when a two-year-old throws a tantrum, he throws himself on the floor and he starts kicking and screaming. When 70-year-old Donald Trump throws a tantrum, he goes to Twitter. It's time that somebody give him his medication. He has tweeted out five tweets against CNN in the last hour. This is a man who's got 4,000 positions to fill, a cabinet to fill, intelligence briefings to attend, and he's tweeted out 13 tweets against inexistent voter fraud and the recount, five tweets against CNN and Jeff Saloni. Come on, you're president-elect. Dude, you won. You're president-elect. Act like it.
Are we living on the same planet as that lady? I mean, this is what CNN does. Trump counters the continued over-the-top, bald-faced lies about him. Thank God we have a president that doesn't have a filter through a bunch of political wonks. That's what they're scared of. The whole bureaucracy, the ruling class, the fifth estate, that's been running this country into the ground, is in total panic mode right now, lying, cheating, stealing, misrepresenting like they've never done before. And the new talking point is that Donald Trump needs medication. As soon as I saw this last night, I thought, I wonder what else they're up to. So I went and I Googled Trump and clicked news. And surprise, surprise, guess what I got? The new talking point had gone out. These people are so controlled that everything they do is put out by the think tanks, and they all go out and parrot it thinking it has a bigger effect. How to keep Trump from becoming president. 25th Amendment could declare a Republican mentally unfit. That's in the Washington Post, International Business Times. It's just everywhere. Meanwhile, the folks that are mentally unfit to rule are the people at CNN that won't let you wear a cross but have women wear hijabs. They're the people that, as we speak this morning, are still asking about the Ohio State attack that they're still, as of last night, calling a gun attack. And here's the headline. Investigators search for motive in Ohio State University campus attack. Gee, he was an Islamist's pledge to ISIS from Somalia. That's been out since yesterday. But not when you go to News One or CNN. Why? Oh, if he'd been some right winger like that idiot at the South Carolina church, it would have been the collective guilt of every white person that he shot and killed nine people. But because it's another jihadi, I don't get the thing with Somalis, man. They are like the very favorite group to ship in by the government. 98,799 Somali refugees settled in the U.S. since 9/11. And the Republicans have been behind it for much of the time, I should add. Charlotte area ISIS suspect expected to plead guilty to terrorism-related charges. That's just another little side issue. 85 languages spoken in Buffalo, New York schools, as Buffalo News basically describes it as the Tower of Babel. No one can learn anything. It's just total collapse, which is the Balkanization plan. Don't make anybody accept English, which, by the way, is the global language. It's the number one language you should learn, then Chinese, then Spanish. Those are the three you need. People try to learn French. No offense to the French. That's the dead language. They don't let it expand. They don't let new words in. English is a mongrel language, so it expands. It's dominant. It's the master language. It will be spoken if humans survive on distant star bases. Nothing else. English is it, just so everybody knows. Because English is not even a language. It is a master language. It's four different Germanic languages. It's several Romance languages. Then it's got Viking, Northern European languages, and they've even found Asian
base words. And that was old English. That's why English takes over, because it isn't a language. It's a mongrel fusion. It's the ultimate mutt. That's why nothing can top English. It's one of the hardest languages to learn as well. But at its base, it's a Germanic language. It is the dominant language. Let's just get that out for everybody. And I don't care what language was dominant, but people are like, oh, have your kids learn French. I'm like, they're going to learn Spanish. They live in Texas. My kids are like, well, I want to take, you know, German. I'm like, sweetheart, you ain't going to be needing German. Okay, let's get that. What about French? No, we're not going to take French. Well, the French teacher's real nice. That's nice. You're going to learn Spanish right now. You need to learn. If you live in North America, you need to learn English and then Spanish. If you live globally, you want to learn English, Spanish, and Chinese. I don't want to digress. It's just these are facts. These are not conspiracy theories. I know I'm a commoner, just an average guy with a giant 40 million, you know, a week listenership now. I'm not supposed to, you know, give you my views. Only CNN can, but I'm just laying out the facts here. WikiLeaks has released more than 500,000 U.S. diplomatic cables. We're going to be going over that. State's first locally transmitted Zika virus found in South Texas. Boy, isn't that great. Now, that's not even our top stories. That's just that particular stack, because we don't know why another Somali went and stabbed a bunch of people. Why? We just have no idea. There's a motive. Even though he's running around screaming, Allah Akbar. Now, I've got so much to get to. Before I get into massive censorship, let me hit this first. Just let everybody know where we stand. There's Quantcast, there's Digital Vision, there's a lot of different internet rating services that mainly use a fusion of Google Analytics and other platforms, and ad agencies really want these numbers, so these are some of the most accurate numbers. When you look at something like Alexa, it had decent numbers, but still a small sampling, so it wasn't one of the better ones to look at even 10 years ago for advertisers, and ad agencies weren't using it 10 years ago. When Bezos, 2.5 years ago, had it delist basically any libertarian or conservative site by 80%, on one day, people just quit using it. See, he destroyed himself. You can only have censorship if there's censorship across the board. You can't have it just in a spot here, a spot there. You automatically discredit yourself. So when I mentioned the ratings, we're 126 on Quantcast. That's much bigger than BBC or the New York Times. And I looked at Quantcast and I compared to our Google Analytics, and I said, well, we're even higher on our Google Analytics. We're like 80-something. And I said, it's weird. I said, Drudge is in the top 10, according to our Google Analytics, if we run his numbers. Which we don't have a lot of time to do this, but I could sit back there all day doing it. We have the access to supercomputers. That's what Google is. And we're partners with it. I'm honest about that. Partners with the devil to be able to, you know, stare into the eye of Sauron and understand what's happening. I said, you know, Drudge is bigger than that. And I said this a few weeks ago. Well, Digital Vision has done their own analysis, and Drudge is number one in news, but number three on the web total, only after what, ESPN and MSN, because MSN has a bunch of email accounts and other people on it. So Drudge is number three in the world total. And I'm not kissing Drudge's butt. I just wanted to be accurate, because our own analysis showed Drudge in the top 10 and showed us at 80-something. This has him at number three total and has us at 84, which, like I told you 2 weeks ago, see, we're pretty accurate with our IT people and third parties looking at the numbers just because we want to know. But what you really take away from all of this is that mainstream media, I mean, every site, is in free fall. And anything that's outside of that, including independent left-wing sites, you name it, are also going up. So it's not just conservative libertarians that are going up. It is anybody that people see as basically unfiltered, like Donald Trump. You know, he just got elected in a landslide of the presidency. But look at DrudgeReport.com right now. X out that Cadillac ad. Boom! Drudge tops election month coverage. 1.7 billion views, best of 21 years. That feels really good, doesn't it? Because if I've seen 100 articles, I'm not going to exaggerate. Without looking in the last 15 years, I have seen an assault level. I mean, it's got to be 1,000 articles saying that Drudge doesn't have any viewers or any visitors, and that Drudge is a big joke, and Drudge is over, and Drudge is old, and blah, 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 blah. As I could go to the Google Analytics or any other rating service and see Drudge only going up. And they do that to us, too. It's like the Mark Twain quote rumors of my demise have been greatly exaggerated. This is what the fake news media does. They're the ones that told you Obamacare was free. They were the ones that told you there were WMDs in Iraq. They were the ones that blamed Iraq and not the Saudis for 9/11. They're the ones that tell you the family's bad and that gun crime's up when it's not. They're a pack of criminal liars trying to lie to you. Do we occasionally, once a week, put out some article that's wrong and I'm calling people going, this is BS, get it down now. Absolutely, we make mistakes. And then I run around neurotically trying to fix it because I really want to be accurate. And sometimes with stuff we say, it's taken out of context. So I got to be careful about that. But that's the media doing that. It's not my fault. But still, I got to be careful. But when it just comes to them declaring that they're the arbiters and they decide, the Washington Post yesterday, we come back, we're talking about this briefly, then get another news. And to their credit, even Rolling Stone came out and said it was bad. And the Guardian said it was bad. Put out this giant list of things they say aren't real news and should be shut down, including Drudge Report and InfoWars. And this is a total blacklist. It's beyond McCarthyism. So this is how desperate they are because we're much bigger than them. So we have to keep declaring that or folks won't understand what's happening. We've already beat them intellectually. Now we've got to remove them politically. Stay with us. You know, I love the end of this song, but I don't want to sit here and play the whole thing. We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there. Another way to say it is the woods are lovely, dark, and deep. But I've got miles to go before I sleep. Can we skip ahead to the end where he goes, oh, Smokey's got his ears on, and he's hot on your tail, and he ain't going to rest till you're in jail. So you got to dodge him. You got to duck him. You got to keep that diesel trucking. So drop that hammer down and give it hell. Good old Mr. Reed. All right, I talked to some famous guitarists that say that that little part there at the end, that almost no one else but Jerry Reed could play that. That little bit of banjo he does at the end, nobody else could figure out how to actually play that. I mean, nobody. I think maybe Jimi Hendrix might have been able to do it. Okay, where to start, where to begin, ladies and gentlemen, in this little short segment. You know, I was thinking during the break why I love Donald Trump despite all his problems, and believe me, I got some too, but I'll be honest, I got some problems with him. It's that he trolls the mainstream media that's been trolling us forever. He stands up to all these discredited nobodies, and he gives it back to them. And then he beats them. And that's what's exciting about it. But they had so many news articles yesterday. When I say hundreds, that's conservative, attacking Trump, saying, Trump's been fact-checked. He's incorrect. Why no illegals voted and no dead people voted. I even saw news articles going, Trump's crazy. He thinks dead people voted. Again, that's preying on their readers, preying on their viewers. When you say dead people registered to vote, you mean people are voting with the names of dead people. No one's saying dead people are voting. PolitiFact. Oh, they're the ones that told us Obamacare was a great deal. Donald Trump, pants on fire, claim that millions of illegals cost him popular victory vote. No, you've just got California and six other states that let illegals, or it's more than that, that let illegals vote without driver's license. It's seven states that passed laws that went to the governor's desk in 2015 and 16 to let illegals vote, but it violated federal law, so they couldn't. So out of one side of their mouth, they're saying, we want the illegals to vote and come on to vote. We have a Democratic strategist on video with Project Veritas. Three different ones. We have the head of the Elections Commission saying, oh, they're bussing people around with dead people's names and illegals voting over and over again. It's horrible. And what does the mayor do? He removes that guy last week for telling the truth. And then they just say, PolitiFact, there's no proof. They caught illegals and other people voting repeatedly from Florida to Colorado. But PolitiFact, oh, that won the Pulitzer Prize. Ooh, is that like the Peace Prize for Henry Kissinger starting all those wars? Is that another joke? So the reality is that they've had pants on fire about me. What they do is they misrepresent what I've even said. Yes, I'm saying the unthinkable. Mainstream media rigs things. They rig the debates. They rig the national polls. It's all come out in the WikiLeaks. The New York Times colluded with the Obama administration and Hillary to target people with false stories, to cover up other stories. We have them. It's done. And so they think we're just going to go away after the election, 3 weeks after, and they're going to announce a fake news initiative and shut all of us down and try to censor us. It's not going to work. Because people see through them, and there are all these new liberty-based sites that are so intuitive, so smart, so informed, just exploding everywhere, and all these new personalities on Facebook and Twitter and all these new radio shows. It's beautiful. My dream is coming true. And I'm not here tooting my horn, but I want you to know the power of human vision. When you've studied history, when you've experienced things, when you've lived it, I saw a renaissance of new media coming. I saw if we warn people about globalism with their own quotes about a worldwide corporate plan for total enslavement, that humanity would respond. And independent media responded, and good people inside our own government agencies responded. I never thought they'd be MVPs, but I just state the facts. They were the key to all this. And just so many other great things happening. It turns out we stood up to evil and other folks joined us. Now, again, we haven't won the whole war yet, but we are kicking their butt. We got them down and we are putting the boots to their ribs. I mean, we're breaking ribs every day, folks. We are putting a permanent hurt on them. And by the way, the New World Order is taking us on an express elevator straight to Hades. I want to get off of it, but we got to admit where we're going if we're trying to turn this around. Now, you know there's a zeitgeist going on when Kit Daniels, like 15 minutes ago at the start of the last break, runs up and he says, hey, this is a big article, and I meant to get to it last segment, I didn't. Then Biggs runs up and has already shot a video about it. I had Jesse Ventura calling me this morning out of time to call him back going, oh, there's your hero, Trump, Alex, calling for arresting people to burn the American flag. And I was just thinking, you're supporting, I don't want to get in a fight with Ventura, but give me a break, man. You're supporting Ventura that killed hundreds of thousands. I mean, you're supporting Fidel Castro, Ventura. You're saying he's a great guy. I don't support arresting people that flag burn because it's their First Amendment, okay? And once you do that, you can ban all their free speech. But I thought it was rhetoric this morning when Ventura called and I heard the voice message. I thought, watch, this will just be some point to point out that the left's trying to take our free speech. They're the ones banning the words mother and father in entrance paperwork for schools. They're the ones saying masculinity is hateful and should be banned. They're the ones trying to restrict our free speech. They're the ones saying shut down talk radio. So if the left cared any about this, if Jill Stein didn't put out tweets praising Fidel Castro as an amazing humanitarian, the guy is one of the biggest mass murderers in history. And I'm sorry, I like Jesse Ventura. I've known him 10 years. I was in two seasons of a TV show. I've traveled the country with him. But he just has kind of gone leftist. And I'll get him on tomorrow if he wants to come on, or today. Hell, call him. I haven't had time. But It's frustrating. I don't agree with Trump on, well, you ought to give, you know, the FBI the code to these shooters in San Bernardino's phone. I mean, they got a warrant. The FBI is manipulating the fact, and I'm not even attacking the FBI here, but they're manipulating the fact that Trump is not technical. That's one of his only blind spots. He doesn't understand that they wanted the code keys to everybody's iPhone. Okay? He's also wrong on torture. Look, if I was out in the battlefield like Joe Biggs' men and some ISIS folks had just used a kid with a suicide bomb to blow up some people, I would probably get angry and torture them. The point is that it would not be premeditated. Because I've talked to family that's been there before. When they set a kid on fire to get the helicopters to land, they try to blow the helicopters up. And then I talked to my family who just admitted they went ahead and just tortured the people to find out what else they were up to so they'd stop them. I get the point that happens at the time. The thing is, you cannot sit there and premeditate it all, or you become ISIS, you become Al-Qaeda. But I get the fog of war. So Trump is so honest, which is refreshing. On one hand, it's very refreshing. On the other hand, though, you can't just say, well, we're only going to torture ISIS or Al-Qaeda because I'm the president and the troops will do it if I tell them to. Well, of course they'll do it if you tell them to. It's still ongoing. Obama never stopped it. He's just now aiding the very jihadis. So the issue is the globalists hate him because he wants to cut taxes, secure the border, do favorable trade deals to end the globalist system that is 50 times more evil than Fidel Castro and 100 times worse than Donald Trump. All of us have problems, but I'm telling you, there's a reason they're so hysterical. But is he giving people red meat? Why is Trump coming out and making these statements saying maybe a year in jail, maybe deport you? Well, if you're actually in a lot of countries and you're not a citizen and you burn their flag or you do stuff, they do say, we're deporting you. So I'm totally for that. I mean, if you don't want to be here, but look at the universities, look at the colleges, look at the culture. It's all anti-American. We're being conquered by globalists, folks. Nobody should be allowed to burn the American flag. If they do, there must be consequences, perhaps loss of citizenship or you're in jail. Yeah, but you can take that so far as I've heard people bitch out folks at 4th of July because they've got red, white, and blue American flag tablecloths. You're disrespecting that. I mean, it gets to a cult level. The flag represents the Bill of Rights, Constitution, Declaration of Independence, and those that fought and died for it. The blue is the sky and God. The stars are the states, the colonies previously. White is, obviously, for the original colonies. And then you've got the red that's for the blood. It can also be symbolized as the bandages. So you desecrate the flag, in my view, when you sit there and don't realize it's just a symbol of liberty. So you have to let folks do it. But I get where Trump's going. He's trying to go the opposite of politically correct to move the Overton window back to Americana. I understand what he's doing. I disagree with it. And it gives major fodder to people that are very proudly calling me up saying, see, I told you your boy Trump's bad. You see, if you were declaring Castro as a brutal dictator, then you'd have standing to say that. Saying maybe we should arrest people for a year that burned the flag and opening up a debate about it is not putting people in forced labor for 10 years for criticizing Fidel Castro. Just saying. Now, going back to this issue, the articles on Infowars.com, Trump trolls media into savaging Hillary Clinton. Hillary co-sponsored flag burning bill in 2005. Just like she sponsored a wall. Everything Trump does is very calculated to show what hypocrites these people are. President-elect Donald Trump trolled the media into unwittingly condemning Hillary Clinton by adopting her position on U.S. flag burning. Trump tweeted this out early today, which sounds similar to the Flag Protection Act of 2005 that then-Senator Hillary co-sponsored. She didn't just support it, she co-sponsored it. She pushed it. And so let's get Kit Daniels there in the InfoWars control room to get his take on this. And we have Joe Biggs' take in studio. Go ahead.
Yeah, Alex, one thing that people need to realize about Donald Trump is that he uses rules of power to dominate. People say that he's not a politician, but he's been using methods of statecraft to craft his real estate business. He knows exactly what he's doing.
Sure,
he's,
just like he said, oh, I'm not going to go after Hillary. I'm going to have foreign governments go after her foundation.
Yeah, you have people like Jesse Ventura, for example, that see something that Trump says or does. They criticize it, but they're looking at it like it's a game of checkers. Trump is playing ninth dimension chess. You know, that's why people like were like, oh, he's an outsider. You know, I talked to a girl that I met that was liberal a couple of months back. She was like, no, we need politicians in politics. We don't need outsiders like Trump. But Trump is an outsider, but he knows exactly what he's doing.
He's an outsider, though, that's an insider with his own game. That's what InfoWars is. It's like Steve Bannon talked about it. He said the left never knew what hit him because they're not even the left. We're the return of Americana, renaissance, of enlightenment, of prosperity. If we can deliver, we will convert the entire country basically to Republican and take us back from the brink. That's the plan. That's why they're saying disassociate from Stephen Bannon, disassociate from Alex Jones, and then misrepresenting what Bannon and I have said. It's not going to hurt me if Trump, quote, disassociates with me, because if he goes sideways, then I'm protected. By sticking with Trump, I'm in the danger if he does go sideways. I don't need Trump. My audience doesn't need Trump. We're the ones that built the liberty movement for him to ride in on. And so he knows that.
Yeah, Alex, it's hilarious to me how Trump is forcing the left to not only defend the U.S. flag as far as free speech is concerned,
exactly,
but now they're defending Americanism.
That's like, it. Oh, so let's explain exactly. You're a genius. Quantify Kit Daniels. You said in your article what he's done. You just said it. He's forced him to defend the republic. He's forced him to defend free speech. He's forced him to defend Americanism, not globalism.
Yeah, so basically what he did in his tweet, and his tweet's meaningless because it takes an act of Congress to do what he's trying to do.
It's not going
to
happen.
Exactly. It's not going to happen. But what he did was he basically took Hillary Clinton's 2005 flag protection bill, took some of that text out of that bill and tweeted it out. Now you got the leftist media, even some neoconservatives that were Hillary supporters in the media, attacking Trump for this position, but it was Hillary Clinton's original position. This
and again, is you just hit the nail on the head. He forces them to defend free speech. He forces them to defend the flag. He forces them to come back from their anti-free speech position. Now he can say, you're the ones that authored it. Okay, and then why are you trying to ban all this other speech? Total, complete, as you said, three-dimensional chess, which is ninth dimensional That's why, and I'm not just bragging, the media's figured this out now. He'll be giving a speech, I'll finish the sentence on live on air and obnoxiously. It's like we're synced up because we are synced up in the real battle plan. This is incredible. Joe Biggs?
Yeah, I saw his tweet this morning. I was like, man, this is going to be epic. Because the left, you know, they're going to automatically come out and start attacking Trump. The right's so bad. You know, how could they do this? How could they not support free speech? You know, meanwhile, they forget that their darling golden girl, Hillary Clinton, back in 2005, proposed pretty much the exact same thing, but except hers was a year in jail or $100,000. And his
even worse than Trump. So let's do this. Let's put the headline out on top of this or doppelgang it. Trump has adopted Hillary's flag burning law. That's all. And try to get these robots to compute that.
But it was funny though. Like my video was basically based off the fact that the left was going to start attacking the right about it, and I just wanted to go, you know what? Look, she did this in 2005. You're eating your own words. You're literally going after him on something that your golden girl that you've been behind for the last year proposed. What is that? 2005? You know, years ago. I mean, that
11 years ago.
Yeah, 11 years ago. So I mean, I just thought it was hilarious. He's a master troll.
Absolutely, for a reason. He shows.
Mm-hmm.
He shows CNN and all these people and Hillary what jokes they are, because as Kit just said, he forces them now to defend Americana and free speech, something they've been trying to gang rape.
Yep. And it's funny, though, yesterday on Twitter, everyone's like, voter fraud doesn't exist. It doesn't happen. I was reading an article yesterday from a local news source in Ohio. There's a lady who was going to jail for 5 years for 3 elections in a row. Voted multiple times, and they found the proof that she did that. She's going to jail for 5 years. Voter fraud does exist.
Oh, I love how they say there's no illegal voters when 7 states passed laws, but then the governors couldn't sign them. It's a violated federal law to let illegals vote. And cities like San Francisco said, we don't care, it's happening. They got caught all over the country, and then they have all these articles saying Trump got his info from Alex Jones. He's wrong. He really lost the popular vote. Bull. Hillary stole 5 states. We've gone over the evidence. We had Bev Harris, who's a Democrat, on. She frickin' stole them and still lost. So try that on for size.
Well, the funny thing is, there was a whole bunch of these leftist celebrities came out yesterday tweeting out, well, I voted for Hillary Clinton 10 times. And another one's like, well, I voted for Hillary Clinton 11 times. And then it was 20 times. And everyone, it was all these verified accounts. And, you know, they're like,
what they're doing is they're flooding it because they know we have the Veritas videos of their insiders saying we have folks vote 10 times apiece. So they're just scrambling all that. They're so desperate to put up a smokescreen, but everybody knows how to identify the enemy. MSM liberal is the enemy. We know who the pack of liars are. Neocons, the enemy.
Yeah. It's it. I mean, at the end of the day, Hillary Clinton's going to go down as the world's largest sore loser ever in American politics.
That's right. And she's doing it through all these fronts like Jill Stein, who, again, put out these breathless tweets. Oh, Fidel was such a magical man, such a humanitarian. Oh, and he was having sex with 5 women a day and smoking cigars, living in palaces while everybody else starved. And oh, and he killed hundreds of thousands of people and launched wars in Angola and, you know, launched wars in South America and did all this. But oh, the New York Times said he was sexy. Oh, he's so cute. Jill Stein praises Fidel Castro, a symbol of struggle for justice.
But they never once, no one got upset about them tweeting this out. I just found it.
Well,
but
I mean, she's all for voting integrity, but she wants a dictator.
But they attack Donald Trump when he goes, Fidel Castro is dead. And it's this huge, like, exclamation mark. Like, he was so excited. I even tweeted out, Fidel Castro is finally dead. You know, there were people in Miami that were celebrating, many which were going, Trump, 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 yelling.
Well, they take everything Trump does and they just reverse it as if it's something bad. Here's the deal. They've been delusional control freaks so long, believing they controlled us. They cannot believe now that we've broken free from them, and it's getting worse by the minute. The erosion of whatever little confidence that was left in them has now become beyond vestigial. It is transitory. It's like a vapor, something like a wisp of smoke you see in the sky. It's over. You're done. Someone asked both of you, and then I got to shift to other news. What happens in the next year, 2 years to Dinosaur Media? They're almost all completely bankrupt. They're being propped up. They couldn't deliver to the establishment despite everything they did. They're only getting more intense now. So where does this go?
Well, Alex, you remember that movie, THX 1138, at the end of the movie where the people are climbing up out of the tubes to reach the free world above them?
Yeah,
the robots that were like, come back, come back. That's pretty much what the mainstream media is now, because they're like, oh, come back. You know, we got to save you from the fake news that's out in the real world outside. And this whole
sure, it's an allegory of Plato's cave.
Exactly.
They're saying, we're over budget. Come back. It's safe down here. Don't go. And enough of us just move against it. They can't beat us.
Yeah, and the whole flag burning thing, this ties back into what I reported a couple of weeks ago about Donald Trump picking Priebus as his chief of staff. And people were like, why would you choose an establishment insider for that position of power? Well, it goes back to what I said about Louis the 14th in his palace, where he moved all his nobles to live with him, and they never had time to conspire, or even the privacy to conspire. That's right,
they always had them fighting with each other.
Exactly. Exactly.
I don't want to say who else had that tactic, but Mr. H did that.
Yeah.
It's very Machiavellian.
Yeah. And people that your former enemies that, you know, if you put them in positions of power, they're going to be more grateful to you than your friends will be because, you know, you had the position to destroy them.
Sure. And they know where all the intrigue is.
Exactly.
And I agree with you to this point. If he starts waffling on the policies, then we go into complete, you know what mode.
Yeah. But like you said, he does have a blind spot with technicalities. That's the one thing about Trump that's been troubling me. You know, he's
and I've confirmed behind the scenes. It's like whenever the Veritas Club had come out of Hillary sending folks to terrorize his events in Chicago, he goes, we saw it on the clips. And they bring him just hundreds of news articles printed out in folders, and then they get like iPads and go, here are the clips, sir. And he sits there and watches them, and they hit the buttons for him. So I'm not putting Trump down, but he is 70 years old, folks, and he knows how to tweet. He does it on his phone, and that's it. He knows Twitter, and then that's it. And so they really use that against him. I wish he could take a course or something. Not that I have all the answers either. I mean, I'm not good at a lot of this stuff, but I tell you.
I think everybody knows that the mainstream media is dead. You know, I was just down in Florida for Thanksgiving, and, you know, that was one of the big states that we kept waiting on to be called on election night. Are they going to call it? It's so close. I just traveled up and down the West Coast and all the way down into the bottom part, almost around to the Keys. There are Trump stickers on almost every car. Trump signs in almost every lawn.
God, I wish they were around here.
It is completely and totally ridiculous. Everywhere I went, Trump hats on, MAGA, MAGA, MAGA. I was sitting in the parking lot of a Walgreens, and I'm waiting on my fiance to go get some baby stuff that she wanted. And I'm sitting there. And there's people coming out of the Walgreens like, oh, my God, InfoWars, what are you guys doing in our town? We love Trump. Look at our hat. Look at our hat. Look at our hat. And everywhere we went, it was this huge, like, just Trump movement. So it makes me just so confused. I'm like, you know, if we really did a recount on a lot of these states, we would probably end up winning most of the states as a whole.
It's totally meant to just discredit our free speech. All right, guys, thank you so much. It was good to have you in here. Good points. All right, I haven't gotten to all this yet. I mentioned this yesterday, but I'm going to re-mention it when we come back from break because it ties into everything we're talking about. This isn't InfoWars.com. This is the London Guardian. And for all its problems, it has some journalism left in it. Pope's possible deal with China to have state-run Catholic Church would betray Christ, says Hong Kong Cardinal. I mean, can you believe we've gotten to the point where we're going to have the Pope who is this pro-globalist minion pushing a merger with communism? You can say what you want about Pope John Paul II and people, but my God, how far it slipped. But, you know, before I get to all this, because I'm having trouble breathing, I'm going to talk about something really important. I actually have my stack of news. When we come back, it's about to happen. And by the way, it was a white cop shot the guy after he'd stabbed a whole bunch of people, critically injuring some of them. And they actually had the local mosque and Islamic leaders come out and say, we notice it is a white officer. You did not let us engage in our holy jihad. I mean, I'm not kidding. The article's on InfoWars.com. With the tweets and the comments from the Islamic leaders and the, quote, social justice warrior Islamicist in the area, we notice it's a white officer. Very interesting. I don't care what color the officer is. Some guy's running around in a gun-free zone stabbing people. Now, I'd already printed this off before the show today to cover it. And it's such a big topic, I should spend a whole hour on it. And I think I'm going to spend some time in the third hour today on it. There was a movie came out that I saw when it came out in the theaters in 2006. 2008, called The Happening. And that's where trees get sick of people. It's an environmentalist movie. They start releasing toxins in their pollen to kill mammals. Now, I grew up in Dallas, and I had friends that wouldn't want to play baseball or football sometimes. They'd say, oh, I got allergies. I thought it was hypochondria. I thought it was made up. Ladies and gentlemen, I moved to Austin in high school, and I got sick for like a week. My mom said, yeah, you got cedar fever. Ladies and gentlemen, I was driving to work this morning, and almost the entire office is sick. And I had to begin to pull off the road. I was coughing so hard and couldn't breathe that I was basically vomiting in my car. In fact, I was, vomit was coming up. And I'm here because this feels a lot better than being in bed. I am going to leave town tomorrow. In fact, I may move InfoWars out of Austin. They admit it is the headquarters of the worst allergies in the country. But here's the deal. My grandmother's from here. She's got allergies now. She's 91 years old, 92. People that never had them have got them. It is epidemic where people are dying. And it's the GMO. It's the chemicals. It tips our immune system over. We're getting so much artificial stuff, we can't handle things we always had before. It's epidemic. And I tied it into also to the 2006 film, Children of Men, where everybody is basically sterile. We've already reached that from Japan to the U.S. Most people are now sterile. Sperm counts are down 90%. The point is, no one's talking about it. We're living in a real movie where 90% of my office is super ill. A lot of folks are out. Everybody I talk to is the sickest of their life. People that have never had allergies, and I didn't have allergies until I was 17, are in hell. I was up all night coughing. I busted a rib. I got a big swole rib from coughing, and I can hardly breathe. And I'm not bitching. The nutraceuticals I take, you know, made me lose weight and get healthier, but I'm gonna definitely get to the natural nutraceuticals I know to deal with the mold, but I've been doing the local honey and bee pollen and stuff, and it just ain't working, man. So I'm leaving tomorrow morning. I mean, it's that bad. I am being driven from Austin. I may have to move headquarters, everything. Because now the damn allergies are 12 months out of the year. Everybody's basically sick. It's the biggest business is allergies. I don't know what is going on, but it's getting bad. Speaking of supporting the broadcast, we've got free shipping extended through today with promo code FREE. We have Cyber Monday extended today with 50% off on Coil Silver, 30% off from Mel Vitality. Great books, videos, materials. InfoWarsStore.com is what funds this independent media operation. I don't know exactly what's going on, but man, everybody knows what I'm talking about. We're just conditioned to accept all this. I'm not. So thank you for your support. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella sign. InfoWarsLife.com is the nutraceutical sign. Amazing supplements there. Call toll-free 888-253-3139. I literally could not talk going to break. I mean, this is like not being able to breathe, folks. This is like having asthma. I mean, I've never experienced asthma, but now I know what it's like. Where, I mean, I can't breathe sometimes for like 60 seconds. I'm turning blue here. This is not fun. Yeah, the allergies are spreading everywhere. It's like out of the movie, The Happening. It's so bad, I've got to evacuate Texas tomorrow. I'll be popping in on the show. And I'm actually looking at areas that have low allergy levels to move the studios the next year. I'm even telling the crew, you want to come with us? We're leaving. We're leaving Austin. Plus, it's been overrun by Californians anyways. And people that try to take over California, the failed Californians, the losers, the lottery ticket wannabe winners, the fruitcakes, the scum. Arizona, they say, used to be good, but now it's bad there too because it's the GMO, folks. It's the chemicals. It's the nanotech. It's triggering everybody. And again, I was somebody, I wasn't allergic to anything. Not bee stings, not penicillin, not opiates, you know, if I had a surgery, nothing. And now I was just racked with allergies this morning. And I got in the car to drive to work, and like, I walked out and got in the car, and it wasn't placebo. It was happening. My eyes were watering. I was coughing. It hurt. I got in the car. I couldn't breathe. I almost ran off the road. I had to pull over. I started to pull over, pulled back out. It's like the media is not going to tell us this is going on. They're going to just act like everything's normal. It's not normal, folks. Autism has gone from 1 in 30-something thousand to 1 in 56. Mental disorders, neurological disorders have gone from even higher numbers to lower numbers. Cancer in pediatrics has gone from unknown to 10,000% increases. I'm telling you, folks, just like I tell you other stuff's going on, something's going on. I ain't got my full head around it, but man, is this like a takeout of the species or something? Because let me tell you, I'm tough. I'm pretty tough. I've been in fights before. I've had like 3 broken ribs, a broken nose, a broken leg, and I'm still fighting. And let me tell you something. It took everything I had today to keep that car on the road. I mean, I was like purple. And I'm just telling you, there's some stuff going down. It's like World War I nerve gas when I went outside my house. I got filters all over my house now, you name it. Is it the electricity? Is it the wireless they think might stir up your allergies as well? Let me tell you something. I'm ready to go get a farmhouse out in the middle of nowhere and run the damn thing off solar or run it off candles. I don't know, man, because let me tell you something. I ain't somebody that's into being sick. And I know when I feel like I've been run over by an 18-wheeler. I'm only here because it feels better than sitting in bed. So, I have had my ass stomped before. And it was preferable to this. I've had people put the boots to my guts, and it feels better than this. This is like fire ants are dumped down my throat. My brain feels like it's about to explode. It's so painful. I'm like, is this a joke? This has been going on for a week, by the way. God almighty. This has been going on for a week. Intense torture. And I ain't the only one. A large part of my office is not even here. I talk to other offices locally. They go, yeah, half our office is gone. Everybody I talk to is sick. People that have never been sick are sick. This isn't Kansas, folks. This isn't normal. We got one of the top professors, algorithm scientists, joining us that predicted that Trump was going to win the presidency with an 86% rate. He's predicted the last 5, now I guess it's 6 administrations. So that's coming up. But let me tell you, there's a lot of stuff going on. The radiation levels are triple what they were 50 years ago in the Northern Hemisphere. I think it's a cocktail of stuff, the toxic waste, the radiation, all of it's being triggered. But my body feels like it's fighting for its life right now. And I'm going to really work on some things to try to mitigate this. But let me tell you, I ain't found them yet. All right, we'll be back. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. I don't care what color you are, you got red blood, and I love you. Yeah, people ask, what is this? Is it liberal versus conservative? No, it's reality versus tyranny. It's an information war, and we've got globalists and corporations that admit they want a hegemonic control over information. That's just not happening. And this whole election, Americanism versus globalism, was a repudiation of that. Now, I've followed the work of Dr. Helmut Northup for at least 2 decades since I've been on the air. And he's a professor of political science. I'm not going to go over all of his PhDs and MAs and the rest of it. But he's the guy with the studies and the algorithms he does that predicted Donald Trump had an 80%+ chance. It varied between 90 and 86. He can give us all the numbers. But we all saw it. Primarymodel.com. And so this is what 4 or 5 administrations, I think it's 5 or 6 now, he can fill us in, where he's dead on predicted. He got a lot of criticism predicting it would be Trump, but the Google algorithm predicted it. A lot of other social network systems predicted it. It isn't hard when Trump had like 10 times the traffic of Hillary and 20 times the crowds. But it is hard to keep predicting inaccurately. But he and others have also looked at it and said it's troubling numbers for people trying to impeach Trump down the road. So he joins us via video Skype. Primary Model 16 is his Twitter, primarymodel.com. is his website. I won't go over his bio. He really doesn't need an introduction. But Dr. Helmut Northup, thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me on your show again. Thank you.
You bet. Where should we start?
Well, we can start at the very end. It worked out terrifically that what I predicted in March came true when a lot of people had said that it would be impossible and that Hillary would be favored. And so it's very rewarding that it turned out the way I predicted.
Well, you did call it again. Explain to people how you do this.
Well, it's a formula that sort of distills about 100 years of elections in this country into a formula. It doesn't take into account polls. It doesn't look at what people say they might be doing or what what kind of things might affect the vote. It really only looks at what happens in elections, in the general elections in November, and then in the primary elections in throughout the year, and most recently, just very early. And there are some very interesting patterns that I found that will tell you ahead of time what's going to happen. So, for example, something that many people have sort of noticed, too, that after two terms of a party in the White House, there's sort of a very good likelihood of change. And this was clearly on the horizon this time, in particular because Obama did not do as well in his reelection than in the first election. And that's sort of a sign that maybe the change that he was introducing is sort of wearing off, and that people are looking for another change. And this is clearly what drove much of the campaign.
Well, Professor, Doctor, I've got my own internal algorithm, and I know this. If you've got 900 plus members of legislatures going Republican, all these governors, 16 members of the Senate, a whole bunch in the House, to me, that is a referendum on we don't want the establishment. If Trump doesn't deliver or die trying very quickly, the public's going to turn against him. But I know in some of your algorithms, some of your formulas, you're saying it'll be the Republican establishment that's actually his enemy, not the public.
Mm-hmm. Well, he certainly has a good chance in his first term to do something, because the first term president, at least that part, is pretty safe. I would say that based on sort of his historical patterns in elections, that somebody like Trump, after doing what he did in this election, will probably have a good chance of getting reelected. Now, in the midterm that he's facing in 2 years, it might be a little different. And we've seen it with Obama, we've seen it with Clinton, we've seen it with some Republicans. There is a chance that there'll be sort of a surge back to the other party. I think that you should expect that. And it sort of depends on whether that's big enough to take away the majority that he has now in the House and the Senate.
Sure. And I pulled the numbers up because I got one wrong here from memory. Democrats have lost 900 plus state legislative seats, 12 governors, 69 House seats, 13 Senate seats. I was saying Republicans gained 16, the Democrats lost 13 Senate seats. I mean, these are massive, massive losses. We were told the Republican Party was about to die and become just a Southern state party, but it seems what the Democrats said basically became the tombstone, so-called, for their party.
Mm-hmm. What I find most interesting in this election, which I don't think anybody expected or predicted, is that Donald Trump essentially won it in three northern Midwestern states, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan, which has now been called for him. And that's a remarkable achievement for a Republican to win, because he had to do it with the kind of voters that used to be very strongly attached to the Democrats, white, working class people, voters in those states. And that's sort of a development that I don't think was foreseen, although if you follow the Trump campaign, I think it was sort of in the making. I mean, that was sort of a design to appeal to exactly that group of voters.
Well, all I know is this. Trump has reached out to minority voters, something the Democrats don't do except for race baiting, talking about tax cuts and things like that. What do you make of Bannon? I don't know if you saw his Hollywood Reporter interview about 2 weeks ago, where he said, we want the Republican Party to take over the next 50 to 100 years if we can deliver tax cuts to poor people, working class, middle class, across the board, and reignite Americana instead of this command and control economy. Looking at all your different models and algorithms, Doctor, mm-hmm. Do you think there's any hope for that?
Well, I don't really have an angle about that. I think,
sure. So what do you see then populism-wise? Or, I mean, what do you see in the tea leaves? It seems like the whole world is turning against globalism, from Germany to France to Spain to the UK. It seems mm-hmm. like Americanism, not globalism, is the credo.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I would say, I mean, he would have to do it probably beyond like tax cuts. I mean, you would have to see some very sort of strong signs that certain jobs are doing well in this country. Like in these states, I think, in Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, I mean, that whole belt of states. And I don't know whether tax cut is the only way that you do that. If there's any way that that you can reverse maybe what is happening to the flow of jobs in those states.
So you're saying better trade deals and infrastructure investment.
Absolutely. I think that's probably the a very strong selling point that he has, and where I think he can count on a lot of Democrats to support that too. So that will be a very good beginning. And if that sort of generates the kind of economic response that people are looking for in these states, I think that could mean that Trump would be able to consolidate these gains that he made in that area.
I think that's an important point you make. It's individuals that create the economy, but it is, like Obama said, you didn't build it. Well, we did build it, but if we don't have infrastructure or trains or trucks or roads, then our individual dreams can't basically be manifest through those systems. In the United States, especially the Northeast, as you mentioned, mm-hmm. I mean, I was there when I was a kid. I was there in college. I've been there recently. It looks like a bomb hit it. I mean, it is falling apart. Mm-hmm. It is scary. I mean, that sounds like a Herculean job to try to fix that.
Yeah, certainly. But I think the party has a tradition of that. I mean, the Republican Party in the 19th century was a party that built like the Intercontinental Railroad and other projects. So then
Eisenhower in the 20th with the interstate highways.
Well, same thing too. You're right. Absolutely. I mean, Eisenhower, that was a big achievement, accomplishment. And so I think there's a tradition of Republicans doing these things.
There certainly is. What do you think, from looking at your demographics and your models, the Democrats were thinking? Because I'm not a super statistician, rocket science like you are, and I mean, you're one of the top brains out there, so I mean that seriously. I can just read at a gut level the tea leaves and see they were so disconnected. I mean, do you agree with that statement? Or, I mean, what are they thinking? Because they only seem to be intensifying their same old race baiting. Everybody I know, I don't care what color they are, they just want prosperity. They don't want more race fighting.
Well, I think what you see is that the Democrats are doing very well in states like California, New York, coastal states with a heavy proportion of minority voters. And a lot of people have thought that the Republican Party would have to compete on that terrain. And clearly, I mean, if we had a national vote, I mean, the outcome might have been different. I mean, we have an electoral college, and that has a certain effect on the way the vote comes out, and it's a pretty narrow sort of victory in these three states. I mean, let's not kid ourselves, 10,000, 20,000, 70,000.
Sure, sure.
And it's very important for, I think, the Republicans to maintain in a strong position that they consolidate these gains. So I think sure. They should particularly look at what you have to do in states like that and surrounding states like Ohio and so on. To be sure that you hold on to that.
Again, Dr. Helmut Northup, one of the top political scientists in the world, is our guest. Now, going after the articles from Fox News, CNN, you name it, is it five elections or six presidentials that you've accurately predicted? I mean, you've never been wrong. That's pretty stunning.
Well, I made the point that in the election of 2000, I predicted the popular vote. By that score, I would have to sort of take a back seat this time because Donald Trump didn't win the popular vote, but I certainly predicted that he would be elected president. So somehow I had a feeling that he would make it in the Electoral College. So somewhere along the line, I might have to make a deduction for my.
Okay, so you've gotten five. Corner. You've gotten five predicted then.
Yes. Yes.
So you're not even counting. This is a victory. Let me just add this. I know you're a scientist. You just go off the data you have. But let's be honest. They admit there's 3 million illegals on the voting rolls, 4 million, well, they actually are saying 20 million in Pew Research, but 4 million they believe voted. And I can pull those numbers up. They say Trump's crazy saying that. That's mm-hmm. in the major research. The numbers vary, but it's in the millions. I mean, come on. I've had Bev Harris, who's a big liberal, but she's the top election fraud expert. She has scientists involved. She said all the anomalies went against Trump. Five states probably got stolen from Trump. So can you speculate about, oh, my God, for the first time ever, your algorithm, your research model wasn't exactly right. You predicted the winner. Oh, but you thought Trump would win the popular vote. Hillary, they have seven states with Democrats getting bills to the governor's desk to have illegals vote. Then they act like Trump's crazy to raise this as an issue. I think it's very legitimate to say without a recount with this whole push for, you know, dead people, again, people voting in dead people's names and others voting. I think it's clear that the Democratic Party is quarterbacking this whole operation, and that you were probably right doctor that he probably did win the popular vote.
Well, I mean, it's a tall order. I mean, it's about 2 million plus right now in the popular vote counts. You need a lot of people who voted illegally to sort of change that balance. So we'll have to see. I mean, I'm sure there'll be a lot of studies, a lot of research done to check the voting rolls and see whether people on the voting rolls are there legitimately or not. I think that's going to be something that's going to happen.
What'd you make of Jill Stein only recounting states that Trump won?
Well, it's sort of curious that she's filing a petition because, I mean, she's not in the running to win anything. And in fact, I mean, she probably, by her campaign, deprived Hillary Clinton of some maybe critical number of votes that would have given, I mean, those three states to her. It's sort of really, really bizarre. It's hard to follow that.
Dr. Helmut Northup, one of the top political scientists in the world, he's predicted 5 presidential elections accurately, saying he didn't predict Trump accurately because he said he'd win the popular 2. Well, look, he was an underdog. You said he'd win. You've been proven right. I'm gonna give you 6 then, okay? Even if you only give yourself 5 in a row, this is becoming just incredibly incredible. Now, looking at this, primarymetal.com has it all broken down. Obviously, it is 2 million votes. Hillary's winning by the popular vote. Sounds like a big mountain to climb, but you're dealing with 330 million people nationally. Project Veritas has all these videos of them admitting that the Democrats are having people vote 10 times apiece. They got caught and arrested all over the country. All I'm saying is it's legitimate for Trump to point that happened. Here's Pew Research about a week before the election.
Here's some shocking new numbers for you suggesting the true extent of voter fraud across this country. Remember, we've been told by Supreme Courts, by federal courts, by the Democratic Party, that don't worry about those voter ID laws because there's not voter fraud. Well, a Pew Research report shows that 1 in 8 voter registrations are, quote, significantly inaccurate or no longer valid, suggesting further potentially some 18 million invalid voter registrations in this country, nearly 2 million dead people. That is, dead, are still listed as voters, and they've got friends who apparently keep them company.
So there you go. And Dr. Helmut Northup, I'm saying Northup, like Northup Fleming, Northup is our guest, primarymetal.com. So, I mean, looking at that, all I'm saying is The Democrats seem to be the main overseers of classical voter fraud, and they got caught quite a bit.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I haven't seen the evidence. I think we have to do some checking of these voter rolls in some states where there are discrepancies and where it looks like maybe some people got on the rolls that shouldn't have been. I mean, I guess it's very easy these days to do that. It's an honor system, and you don't need much proof. And but I think that's going to be a big thing to look into in the future.
Primarymodel.com, Professor Northup. We've only got 5 minutes left. I want to give you the floor because you're the expert just on demographics, trends, other amazing predictions you've made, because it's not often we get to talk to the Oracle here, who's got about a 99% accuracy rate. It is scary. So let us inside that brain. What else do you see out in the future?
You mean this country and some other countries?
Wherever you want. I mean, nationalism against globalism. Sure. You've got the floor for 5 minutes.
Well, I'm right now. I've been asked by somebody in France to predict the French presidential election, where you might have a very similar development coming up. You have a very strong candidate on the right, Marine Le Pen. It might be quite a shock if she wins on top of Trump and Brexit. So that might indicate a very sweeping change in other countries. Germany is next year. I've done some forecasting of German elections in the past. I've been lucky a couple of times getting it right. And there, too, you have developments that are very disturbing to the established parties. They're being challenged from sort of Trump-like movements and political parties. So I see a lot of opportunities to extend my forecasting expertise, and many of these models are clearly built on what I've done in this country. I mean, the basic idea is that you have some notion about how sort of elections change over time. There's a pendulum swing. The candidates that are in the running how strong they are. Some countries have primaries like France, others have not. So I find I have a busy agenda on my hands in the next couple of years.
Dr. Hellman Norpeth, what should Trump do if he wants to get in a second term? I mean, looking at these trends, what should he do to complete his agenda according to your algorithms versus what will hurt him?
Well, I think we've talked about that already. I think he has a popular program about infrastructure, which will have economic benefits in states that he needs to hold on. Any kind of economic setback in the overall economy will not be good for him. So presidents sort of do rise and fall with the economy. He's facing challenges in the Middle East. He'll have to decide what to do or not to do. Russia is a threat. We're still wondering how sort of his relationship with Putin will play out. He seems to be a little chummy with him. And of course, the Chinese. I mean, he has made big statements about what to do about China. If that sort of creates tensions and maybe a confrontation, all these things are things that will decide whether he will get reelected or not.
So talking to Professor Dr. Hellman Norpeth, it sounds like you're saying it's Trump's to win or lose. It's really up to Donald Trump.
Yes, absolutely. I think in the first term, after you come to power the way he did by defeating the party that's been in the White House, you are generally extended the benefit of the doubt by the electorate to do what you set out to do. And I think the electorate is sort of forgiving, even if things don't work out perfectly. I mean, you saw that with Obama 2012. You saw it with Bush in 2004, Clinton 96. So that's definitely a pattern historically that a real first term president has a pretty good chance to get reelected.
And he's got what most new presidents don't have. He has the trifecta, the executive, the legislative, and of course the judicial. It's Trump's to lose.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's a very good point. And I think it should be emphasized that we haven't really seen that in history very much, especially for the Republican Party. Like Reagan didn't have that advantage. Bush didn't. Nixon, Eisenhower. So Trump is in a really very unique position, which is sort of maybe ironic because he didn't run as a sort of a standard Republican. But maybe that's exactly the recipe why he did it. So and I think some of the things, I mean, that he wants to do, he probably can count on Democratic support, and he has to maximize that wherever he has an opportunity to do that. That's what he should go for.
Donald Trump, we are all here participants, not just viewers. We are in the arena with Donald Trump, all of us together. This is an amazing time. And I got to tell you, Dr. Hellman Norpeth, very impressive. I'll give you 6 predicted right, because, I mean, you did say the president. I get you said popular vote, too. Because I think there was fraud. So I'll give it to you. You have predicted 6 elections. That is unprecedented. And let me tell you, I really respect you for that. Please join us again, sir.
Well, thank you very much. Glad to do it anytime.
Wow. Okay. Well, primarymodel.com. Thank you, sir. I tell you, you talk to like William Binney, former head of the NSA and stuff. Those guys like this guy, they got big brains, man. It's amazing. It's amazing. We'll be right back. Stay with us. We've got a lot of news to cover. Imagine your brain is so dialed into data that you can predict 6 elections in a row. That's the guy we just had on. That's why I just love humanity and love what God created. And that's why I know we're made in the image of God. You can go to the levels of like these sculptors and these musicians and these writers and or these farmers or these cooks, these chefs. I mean, or these people that create these incredible engines for race cars or helicopters. I mean, humanity is amazing. And that's why I get so sick of hearing how we're bad all day. I can take the stupidest person out there and turn them into something if I have the time and energy to do it, and if I give them the confidence. And everything about this political correct system is about taking your confidence, making you feel like everybody's out to get you and the whole world's against you. But the truth is, there are some racist people out there. They're usually losers or they're globalists. The truth is, the companies and systems that are out there that are operating that aren't globalist, they're just looking for cool people. They're just looking for normal folks that don't have an axe to grind and want to get stuff done, and want to have a good time. I know that's all I want to do is help people and build things and get along and be happy. But we've got such arrested development in this country. Now, I've only plugged once today, and we're an hour and a half into the transmission. And I've had the accountant come over and say, hey, you need to fund the operation, Alex. You need to plug the sponsors. And Lord knows that's true. But the fun part is not sitting here plugging stuff. That's why I got rid of most of our sponsors. A lot of them were great, but I can't sit there and vet them and deal with them and play games with them and take them to dinner and play with their winkies and all the rest of it. I just don't do it. I just don't have time for it. That's why 70% of what we do is funded by you with InfoWars Nightly News memberships and the paid app, InfoWars.com/app. And so when I tell you thank you for creating this, it's not talk. It's not I'm just patting you on the head. You don't support us, the oxygen's off, we're dead. You support us, we get stronger, we get meaner, we get more focused. You don't, I'm running around like a fire drill trying to just keep the thing afloat. Then people point out I'm the main reason that we have to sit there and worry about money sometimes because I don't care about it. I really don't. It's not that I'm ashamed of money. I love free market. I don't want to turn people loose, but money and status is not the end-all be-all for me. It's way down the totem pole. Free will and free association and dominating and crushing tyrants and pedophiles and serial killers. I mean, I'll be honest. You ask the other day what I'm into? I'm into crushing evil. I'm just going to be honest with you. And I wish other people had that instinct. I'm here to reignite that instinct so people understand what life and free will is all about. But briefly, we've had specials last week. The biggest specials of the week now all combined are Cyber Monday. I did not really plug it yesterday, so I'm extending it today, maybe even tomorrow. I don't know. Some of these products are selling out. So some of these will end. We got 30% off. Super Male Vitality, an amazing product. Just go research it for yourself. Just take it. See what I'm talking about. 50% off high-quality colloidal silver. 30% off. Again, I guess I have Super Male Vitality twice in my stack here. Can't say enough about that. That's available. And we have extended Black Friday preparedness right through Cyber Monday and Tuesday. Get 30-40% off InfoWars high-quality storable food. InfoWarsStore.com. And of course, we have Black Friday extended right through Monday and Tuesday. 30% off Survival Shield Nation Iodine X2, as I mentioned. There's a lot of other specials. You can sign up for auto ship on things that are obviously reorderable, like Brain Force Plus or Secret 12 or BioPCA or Living Defense, Deep Cleanse, Lung Cleanse, Bio True, Selenium. Knockout, Sleep Aid, Anthroplex, Winter Sun, Liver Cleanse, Oxy Powder, Prostaguard, Bone and Joint Formula. The Oxy Powder is amazing. InfoWarsLife.com. And you can get really high quality products at the lowest prices. These are definitely the lowest prices of the year when you just talk about specific items. And quite frankly, we run sales a lot more than we used to just because for whatever Pavlovian reason, people buy when we do it. So if we can sell a lot more at a lower price, I'm going to do it. All I know is I want to get more camera people. I want to get more reporters. I want to get more researchers. I need legal where it's not just farmed out, but I don't want to oversee my reporter stories, but man, we're into dangerous waters at these points. This is big stuff. We got the whole world watching and I try to get stuff right and I get it wrong sometimes. So big fish eat little fish. And I learned a long time ago, it was like 12 years ago, people were trying to sue me and shut me down. And I wasn't trying to be a big operation, but I was already having such a big effect. And I realized, big fish eat little fish. They're trying to guilt me all day because I make money or I sell products when that's total freedom. That's free association. They think I'm trying to make money and trying to be big. I guess it's my responsibility to really show them what I can do. And I've been on air 21 years. And let me tell you, we've shown them what we can do. If you look at InfoWars now, there's nothing bigger in media worldwide except for Drudge. And Drudge is a special creature because it's one website and a Twitter. And it's number three in the new ratings. It's up on InfoWars.com for multiple rating services on the web. Only ESPN and MSN, because it has something like a 500 million email users, I guess, is why it's like the new AOL or whatever. So it's not about who's big, but it's about, again, restating over and over again to think about that. It's ESPN, Bread and Circuses. It's MSM. And it's Drudge Report. Digital Vision has a big breakdown on it. We're like 84 or something on the list. And I have no desire to ever be bigger than Drudge. I could care less. It's a real pleasure to see them try to kill Drudge and do everything they could, and he only got bigger. Like twice as big than last time. Biggest year he ever had. Biggest month he ever had. Same thing for us. It just gives me a lot of hope. A lot of hope. Because everything they've done has only blown up in their face. And to be bigger than the BBC and the Hollywood Reporter and Wired and just all of them really illustrates what a joke the New World Order is. And again, InfoWars.com is an okay website. It's got great articles and stuff, but it's like older generation, not even that good. Just imagine what we do with the resources. But InfoWars, like I told you, according to the Google algorithm, is on average per month 23% of our reach. You add all our stuff together, it's as big as it gets. And that's not a power trip for me. It's a responsibility. It actually makes me feel sick. Because every minute I'm not fighting, every minute I'm not engaged is minutes the enemy's winning. And I now have gotten on the same level playing field with these people. And I have sworn my entire life that I would fight tyranny. And I have prayed over and over again that God take me over and make me a vessel to resist these people. And then now it's happened. And I see where the road leads. And I just hope this body and these cells are strong enough to handle this. Because I'm in constant presence of God. They call it the Holy Spirit. And, I don't think the average person can, I can't deal with this discernment. I can't deal with this. The Bible repeatedly talks about being in the presence of God. You feel dirty and like your best works are rags. Being in the presence of God is to constantly feel like you're being dressed down. Even though God loves you, when you're in the presence of God and life and everything good, it's very humbling. And then I look at these arrogant corporate whores who spend all their time trying to deceive their fellow humans and deserve evil. And just looking at them, I feel dirty. And my God-fearing cells absolutely recoil. And I say, God, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to look at them. I don't want to face them. I don't want to fight them. And in the same millisecond, God says, you asked for this. And so you know the answer. And it's still free will, but I'm far beyond that. I asked for this, and I am now, as impure as I am, as twisted as I am now possessed. I am now completely turned over to fighting evil. And it is incredible now how far I can see. It's indescribable now. And I just wish that the enemy could see what I saw. Because if they ever saw this, they'd know the world cannot deliver them. They want to be powerful. They want to be informed. They want to be strong. God was all those things. But know this. you're not living in the middle of some boring thing here. Your life has incalculable value simply because you're conscious. And it's the decisions you make, every one of them are a ritual, which just means energy in the universe. What we do on this planet that we think of as insignificant, floating around the edge of a spiral galaxy, sends shockwaves through the universe. And I'm not going to get any more metaphysical than that because the enemy will turn it against people. But just know this planet is very important. What we do now is going to have reverberations like a seed, like a mustard seed of the earth, that are incalculable. But just know this, evil will fail. This corruption, these people that want to, can you imagine one of these super pale, I don't say that to be anti-white, but just super pale with some weird regalia, comes waddling in to rape some three-year-old. I mean, can you imagine serving a God that does that? Can you imagine being Hillary Clinton, who they now announce is planning to run in 2020? Talk about arrogance. Talk about not knowing her expiration date is up. I got a lot of clips I want to play. I just want you to know that evil and good is real. The spiritual realm is real. The enemy knows that. They try to keep you out of that all day long because the minute you realize God's real, all their TV, all their Hollywood, all their awards, all their red carpets are jokes. And I don't call the system a joke so I can feel like I'm better than it on a power trip. I feel sad and embarrassed for them. They'd sell their souls for recognition from things that are so empty, they don't even have any essence. And because they don't have an essence, they seek to destroy those that do. Innocence, the pure of heart. It's the metaphor of the zombie wants to eat your brain because it doesn't have one. And we shouldn't take pleasure in the fact that our enemy's so fallen. We should regret the fact that so many did fall and do our work now to make sure others don't. I've got a few video clips I want to play here before we go to break. Come back with more news. I got a whole other hour to host here with my voice out. But I have several video clips that we were mentioning earlier that I think are extremely important. I think I've lost my video list, but there was some really important. That's right. That's exactly what I wanted to go to next. You're a genius how you knew what I wanted to go to next. Here it is. I found the list. Let's look at these students with smartphones and cars. And I'm not saying the smartphones are good. Just they have more choices. They have more wealth. They have more medicine. They have more options than anybody in the world's ever seen. And they sit there and look at Castro's Cuba, a failed hellhole. And these university students, AU students, prefer Castro to Trump. And then we have a clip of Vicente Fox saying the men are the two and the same. Here it is.
Do you have a more favorable opinion of Fidel Castro or Donald Trump?
That's a tough question.
Oh, boy.
That's a tough question.
That is a tough question.
I mean, right now, I don't think Donald Trump is very good, and I know that Fidel Castro has done some good things for the world, so I'd say he's proven himself, at least in the long term, to be more favorable, in my opinion, than Donald Trump.
He was a remarkable leader in many ways.
Oh, that's really hard. You wanna go first? That is a tough question. Okay. I would say, like, at this very moment, I have a better opinion of Fidel Castro.
Oh my God. I don't. Either way, I just don't. Fidel Castro, that I never really had an opinion on to start with, other than he was really, really bad for the world. Donald Trump, I still don't have an opinion on. I just choose to ignore it.
If it's anything like, if his administration is anything like he said it will be, then I think that Fidel Castro will absolutely have been a better leader to the Cuban people than Trump will be to the U.S. just based on his.
We come back, we're going to play Vicente Fox's response to all this, but if you're not a TV viewer, you miss it. These people look half dead. They can hardly talk. Their eyes don't point the right direction. I'm not being mean. These are half dead people. They're in a dream state. They're into how they're all in charge because they're part of the mothership program, not realizing they're getting worthless degrees to be worthless slaves in a system that already decided there'd be a world better off without humanity. They were caught to commit cultural and spiritual suicide. They never even knew what hit them. So Donald Trump's never imprisoned anybody for their political views. He's never launched wars in Angola or in Latin America. He's never arrested people en masse and cut their genitals off like Fidel Castro mentally did. But that's okay because he's trendy. He's anti-American, so it's cool because our big universities, paid for by robber baron, said so. But here's Vicente Fox comparing both men to each other, saying they're both evil con artists. Here it is.
Well, Cuba is going to be a great Latin American nation as soon as they get rid of the Castro. So nobody needs dictators. And by the way, that kind of dictatorship, that kind of authoritarian leaders, is very similar to Trump. They lie, they cheat, they are false prophets, they promise many things, but they are not going to be able to comply. So we need
comparing Donald Trump to Fidel Castro is beyond the pale. Fidel Castro was a murdering thug who tortured people, who imprisoned people, and quite frankly, Mr. President, I ask you to take that back, comparing Fidel Castro to Donald Trump.
No, I don't take it back. I insist on his genius. They are similar, authoritarian. They impose their wills. They only think that they have the right and the reason. He only won, in the case of Trump, with 25% of American support, American citizen support, that it doesn't give him enough of a mandate to impose his own ideas over a nation and over the world.
President, thank you for being here. Former president of Mexico.
A pleasure. Thank you.
Vicente Fox.
Thank you. And God bless us in front of Trump.
And Fidel Castro was a murdering dictator who crushed the freedoms of his own people.
I'll say this. Vicente Fox was no dictator. So he's no Fidel Castro, but comparing Trump to him is just ridiculous. And look, Vicente Fox is really a Texan. That's where all their property is and all their money. He's like a Texan that went down to Mexico to run stuff. Whatever, man. You're just getting attention on Trump's back. Trump is not a dictator. Trump didn't do things Fidel Castro did, and that's not fair to compare those two. It's BS. It's total BS. Mind-blowing. But I'll give Fox this. He does actually know about the history of Cuba and Mexico, and what the communists tried to do in Mexico was very nasty, actually. Again, when you know real history, you're almost cursed with it because you're informed about it. You know what's going on. You know what's unfolding, and the general public doesn't. And I don't say that in an elitist way. You're like trying to talk to folks just to understand what you're saying. Now, Paul Watson, is he hosting the fourth hour today? I know he's under the weather like I am. He was going to let us know earlier. I'm going to host the third hour. And we got a bunch of clips, but I'm also going to take your phone calls, whether you agree with me, disagree with me. What do you think about what Trump's up to? What do you think about what's happening with all these calls for censorship? All the topics I've thrown out, all the issues I've raised. Hillary's planning to get another run for 2020. They have her brain in a jar, like Drudge says. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Now, Paul Watson is putting on the big boy pants. And he's going to be hosting from London, England, the fourth hour today, and I will host the third hour coming up at 800-259-9231. Again, I don't have the flu, I don't have a cold. We have the worst allergies Austin's ever had. Whether it's coupled with chemicals, I don't know. Almost everybody's sick, and I have never had allergies one-tenth as bad as this. This is, again, 20 years ago, I thought allergies were something that hypochondriacs had. Now I've learned they're very, very real. The only reason I'm here on air is I love to fight tyranny, and it's a lot more painful sitting in bed, laying down with this stuff. So I'm going to stay real busy today till I get real tired, because laying down is like getting kicked in the ribs.
We're trying to add the Sasquatch to the endangered species list here in California. We just needed a few more signatures just to help save the animals. Want to just give us a print birth date signature just to...
You got to be kidding me, man.
So it would make it a felony for anybody who shoots one.
What is today?
Oh, that's a birth date.
Oh.
Yeah, to...
What is...
Birth date signature to save the Sasquatch. There's only a couple of them around, so we just got to make sure nobody shoots them. Thank you.
Yep.
A lot of deforestation is happening, and it's taking away the Sasquatch's homeland and habitat. So we're going to try to add them onto the endangered species list.
Cool.
And that'll make sure nobody goes hunting for them, too. So
have they seen them?
Thank
up
you
there?
So much. Yep, up in Northern California is one of the spots where they're up there. So a couple different species of them, they think. So we're just making sure we're going to add them to the endangered species list, just so nobody goes and tries to shoot one. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, my gosh. Make sure to save the Sasquatch. This is too insane. Look, people are up there trying to hunt them and cut the habitat down, so Sasquatch needs to be put on the endangered species list, and we're going to take care of that. Thanks for supporting that, guys. You're an animal lover. We're trying to get the Sasquatch added on to the endangered species list. No? We support Save the Sasquatch? No. The Sasquatch up there is having its habitat taken away. And
the
so,
Sasquatch? Like Bigfoot?
Yeah, a lot of people are up there trying to hunt for him and stuff, so we're just going to be getting him put on the endangered species list to, just so it would be a felony. It would be illegal to shoot him. A lot of people are out there hunting for him, so
I'm all right.
We want to make sure to save him, bro.
Yeah.
We're trying to add the Sasquatch onto the endangered species list up there in Northern California. A lot of people are out there hunting and cutting habitat, so just to...
Yeah.
Birth date, signature... Just to make sure nobody's can go up there and start hunting for them.
Got you.
There's only a couple of them left, and we need to preserve them. They have a right to live.
Got you, man.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Signature to save the Sasquatch. We're trying to add them onto the endangered species list. Just to. Oh, you saw the camera. Signature to save the Sasquatch. We're trying to put them on the endangered species list to help make sure nobody. No.
You cannot be serious.
Oh, we're trying to put the Sasquatch animals on
I'm
the
not just
endangered
saying this.
Species
Black
list.
People seem to be more wise than white people about scams in these videos. Then why do they go along with the Democrats?
So. If you say saying. So, how's that?
You're going to say down here, right?
Birthday signature to save the Sasquatch.
Good God.
You know, a lot of these trophy hunters are out there looking for them.
Okay.
We just want to make sure that they can't shoot them and save them. Thank
That's
you.
That's a good call.
Appreciate that.
That's a good call.
Oh, my gosh. The world has gone mad. A lot of hunters are up there hunting for Bigfoot, and we
well, need to Trump make sons
them on the endangered species list to protect birthday, too, to save the Sasquatch. I really appreciate that.
There you go.
A lot of people just want to trophy hunt those things.
Again, we're not doing this to make fun of them, folks.
Wow.
These people that believe Donald Trump's a racist.
What's wrong with these people?
A lot of trophy hunters are looking to kill the Sasquatch here in California, and so we're just going to be adding him to the endangered species list just to make sure he's safe. So
nice.
I appreciate your support. Signature to nice. Save the Sasquatch. We don't need the endangered species like him being hurt, so just want to give him the protection that's needed.
Okay.
Especially in California. A lot of rare animals get hunted by the trophy hunters. I mean, if there's one thing we can do, it would be we want to just make sure to keep Bigfoot safe.
So. You know, I realize we have some new listeners, maybe mainline people.
Thank you.
Bigfoot doesn't exist.
Just to shoot him just because he's
the Yeti, whatever. It's never been proven.
You know?
So, this is made up. This is satire. Before the news says that I believe that Bigfoot's about to be killed. Ladies and gentlemen, the globalists are committed to anti-human operations. They want a system of conquest. And I want to make it very clear, we don't have to have some fancy pants system to oppose them. We're simply not trying to create poverty and enslave people. That's why what we're selling is like snow cones in hell or thermal underwear at the North Pole or iced tea in the middle of the Sahara. It sells itself. Globalism is an anti-human system designed to create poverty and control populations. And so all we've got to do is tell the truth, nothing more. That's why they want to get rid of venues where we can tell the truth, is because we're dominating them. Not just InfoWars, not just Drudge, not just WorldNet Daily or Daily Caller or Breitbart, but college students of every race, color, and creed, high school kids. I see stuff everywhere where, oh, look, this girl's got 20 million views on this video. Let's go to her channel. This girl's got 200 million views the last 6 months. Wow, we should get her on as a guest. I don't go, oh, look, this girl's got 100 million views. That's God. I'm like, oh, thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Oh, thank God Drudge is number one. Oh, good. Oh, because I'm so exhausted. I just want to beat these people, man. God, they're bad. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I'm really ashamed watching mainstream media, the frothing, the lying, the spinning. Yeah, I didn't even get to this. I was going to start the show with this today. Just, I just thought of this. Let me see if I can find it. You guys Google International Business Times or AP. Oh, guess what? Trump's mentally ill. He's mentally incompetent. We'll get rid of him via the 25th Amendment. And they've got all these articles where they say this, and then they say, oh, but no one wants to get rid of Trump. It's a conspiracy theory, and he's mentally ill. And then panelists, give Donald Trump his medication, CNN. He's a spoiled brat throwing fits. Meanwhile, they're running around burning things down, killing people, attacking people, throwing fits, and then saying things about Trump, who has just inhuman stamina at 70. Let me tell you something. Trump's a weird mix of classic bravado, virile nature, but also OCD. I tell people that know him, he loves reading a complex contract. He loves making hundreds of phone calls. He loves working 20 hours a day. They call that mentally ill. I call that super male. And compared to most guys, I'm a super male, which I'm not proud of. I'm kind of like a weak guy. Trump at 70 completely trumps what I'm able to do. They want me to read contracts around here and make business calls, which I have to do every day after the show. I'm like, I've got to learn to be like Trump. He takes each one like, oh, yes, let me enjoy this call and make sure I have the very best on the phone and sound just like I have perfect diction and have all the answers. And you should talk to Trump. It sounds like you're talking to like a Hollywood movie star. It's like, hello, Alex. Well, that's good. Let's discuss this. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, yes. You talk to Trump. He has like every number, every fact. He comes right back with the answer. He finishes your sentences. It's like, is this even real? You know what? Trump is the greatest thing we've ever seen, or he's the devil. I've said that before, because talking to Trump off air, which I've done some, they make a big deal out of it, so I won't even tempt the media with it. I'm sitting there talking to Trump, and it's not annoying because it's so creepy. It's like, cool, he finishes your sentences. And then you're about to ask a question, and he goes, and now you're going to ask me this. And you're like, how the hell did you just do that? Let me just hear by a newsflash. The Trump you see on TV is the dumbed-down Trump for the general population. The real Donald Trump is even scarier. And that's why they're so scared of him. Because I've talked to a lot of people. I've been around a lot of billionaires. I've been around a lot of smart people. And maybe he turns it up when he talks to me. But let me tell you, when I talk to Donald Trump, the guy's reading my mind. Maybe he's bad then. My gut tells me he's not. But Donald Trump's a whole other ballgame. Whole other ballgame. Whole other enchilada. I want to go to your phone calls. I've got a lot of video clips I haven't gotten to as well. But don't think I take any pleasure off of playing a clip of Mark Dice showing dozens of Californians thinking Bigfoot is real. We do that. He does that, too, to illustrate that those of us that are politically involved, we tend to back off and not be arrogant because we're not arrogant. But let me tell you something. When you're talking to zombies, sometimes all they listen to is arrogance, or you could call it confidence. But I'll ask this question again. Because it wasn't a foil, it wasn't a shill, it wasn't a feint, it wasn't a scam, it wasn't a neocon deep play. Why does Trump upset them so much? And then you'll have the answers to everything. Now think about that a lot. Why does Trump upset them so much? And then you have the answers. Like a lot of the office crew, and I get what they're saying. Petraeus goes to Bilderberg. Petraeus has been a globalist. But I was told long before he got indicted, they were going to indict him. He was trying to kick the CIA out of the Pentagon and actually try to get real intelligence. So I kind of get the inside baseball. And then I saw them indict him. And I know he goes to Bilderberg. I'm not defending Bilderberg. We helped expose Bilderberg. There are bad people running it. But because you're a guest at Bilderberg, like Peter Thiel, doesn't mean you're bad. It means that our movement's grown so much, they've got to invite people like that to Bilderberg. I mean, I've been invited to New York. I didn't do it because it was the Kissinger group inviting me to it. If Petraeus was made Secretary of State and did bad things, then I'll go completely ape. What matters is the fruits of a tree. And that's not some apology for Trump. He's pointing a lot of good people. And that becomes a big circus in and of itself. All I care about is results. Not in justifies means. I'm not going to say do bad things, get good things. No. I'm saying you put people in, you actually run them, they actually deliver, they actually mea culpa. Let me tell you, one of our biggest weaknesses is we're not ready to win. This is one of the most important things I meant to say today as I was driving into work. I'm going to go to your calls. I envisioned everything that's basically happening now 25 years ago. And I was desperate in high school, 25 years ago, about to get out of high school. I'm 42 now, that I had this mission. And I had to defend the Republic, and I had to warn people, and I had to expose the globalists. And I'd read Barry Goldwater's book, and I'd read Tragedy and Hope, and I'd read books by the globalists, and books for the globalists, and books against the globalists, and just history books that reported on the globalists. And I knew their plan, I knew their program, and I had this sense, I've got to do this now. I've got to fight them. I've got to warn people. And it wasn't so I'd be on some TV show, or it wasn't so I'd make some money. Because I already had all that. I wasn't rich, but, you know, things were taken care of. You know, family dies, you get stuff. Cattle die, kinsmen die. One thing that never dies is fame of a dead man's deeds. It's the old Norse saying goes. But I took my inheritance and put it into things that were real because I really cared about people. It's not about getting up and talking about how I love people, but it's just compared to what we do to what they do, it's night and day. And I envisioned building the resistance, and I envisioned, I've said this thousands of times, it never happened. It finally happened with Trump. I always thought in my spirit that I would expose this, and then better men than me, smarter, stronger, more intuitive, more psychic, more aggressive, more male, would hear my call as I blew the horn, that they would come, and that we would defeat it together. And that started to happen finally. Up until about a year ago, I wasn't sure. I was like, my vision tells me that I'm not the one that's going to lead all this stuff, that I'm like preparing the ground, and that's my job. I've said that over and over again. And then finally, I'm seeing in different agencies, different corporations, different individuals, I'm seeing amazing people. That's why I said on election night when Trump had won, like, 3:30 in the morning after he'd won, I went there and shot a live video, and I said, I'm going to go on. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to continue on, but they could kill me now. Not that I would ever commit suicide. God, I'd never do that. I'm saying they could kill me now, and my work would be done. Not just in Trump, but that nationalism, that wavelength, that awakening, the males and females awakening. I knew that with you, the listeners, that I was begging to help me. I didn't have the power as a little putty to push the big domino over, but I asked you for help, and together we pushed it, and now it's crashing into them. And as we have more success, it's only going to get more intense. And as long as we hold true to our doctrine of liberty, as long as we don't sell out, as long as we are true and promote free will and free market and free association and freedom of religion and everything America really is, we're going to win, because we're promoting something that's so much more popular, so much cooler, so much more real than anything these people can sell. And in that is the essence of victory. So, Donald Trump in history is a key figure. I think that's clear. But what's more important is that you realize you are important, and that the light of God shining through the space-time continuum goes through your soul. And our flesh is like a rose-colored darkly through which it flows, but the distortion only adds to the majesty of it, doesn't it? God's plan, like lightning from heaven, writ large. Your calls are straight ahead. I've already seen everything there is to see on this planet. There's nothing more. All there is the things of God. And you won't learn that in a big, fat, evil church. I want to go to your phone calls right now and a bunch of news I haven't hit yet, breaking news. But right now we've got Tom and Dan and Charles and Jay and CJ and others. Tom in London, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Alex. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you, sir.
I spoke to you 2 or 3 months ago. I said that I'd put a bet on Brexit and Trump, a combination. That was in the middle of 2015.
I think you called. You bet both of them would pass.
Yeah, both of them would pass as a combination. They gave me 220-1 at the time.
I remember you called and said you made the bet. I was interested in that. Tell us about it.
Yeah, well, it was in July 2015. It was a theory I had about the negative reinforcement phase that the establishment was going into, and how they had to do a controlled sort of detonation of these sort of patriotic nationalists.
That's right. They couldn't control the patriotic wave taking place, so they would create a false one to control it.
Yeah, exactly. So, and that's what I think Brexit was. And that's what I think Trump is. Yeah,
that all makes sense, but here's the deal. It's all spiritual. People always tell me I'm controlled or I got some order or somebody runs me. I'm not. I mean, I really am independent. And so I know for a fact Trump is independent. I'm not saying some satanic great knowledge can be manipulating everything, but look, they tried to steal it from Trump. They did everything they could. They're legitimately destroyed themselves trying to stop him. I just don't know if I can say there's total validity. You know, I've even talked to a lot of folks who are smart people, government people. You know, they go, well, how do you know Trump's not a neocon deep play and all this stuff? I've heard that from multiple folks. And it's just like they had their deep play. They think we're stupid. They want to sell us a woman because, you know, she's a woman. It must be okay. I mean, what's your inalienable, inert, prima facie, on its face proof that this is some type of synthetic BS?
First of all, I mean, I do think Trump is a genuine player himself, but he's there to sort of bring out the ideas but which got him where he is, and the same with Brexit. So then that all can be discredited. But the evidence that I would cite, starting with Brexit, I mean, I think both elections were stolen for Brexit and for Trump. I mean, starting with Brexit, there were no public exit polls for the first time in a very long time, and the exit polls are always extremely accurate. But there were private ones. UKIP had their own one, and so did the Tory party, the Brexit wing, and Remain had their private one. And those exit polls said that Remain won by 4 or 5 points. And we know that from Remain, but we also know it from UKIP. UKIP's private exit polls caused Nigel Farage to do something quite extraordinary on the night. Early on in, you know, not very long after the polls closed, Nigel Farage conceded. He actually conceded the whole thing. And then the initial results were...
Yeah, but if you've got a bunch of fake national polls, that's why somebody would do that. Let me ask you a question. Because you've called before. Are you a Muslim?
I'm not a Muslim.
I think you've called in before, like, critical of me criticizing Islam, right?
I might have a long time ago.
Well, the point is that I'm not against the individual Muslim. I want them to have a great life. Obviously, my wife or whatever doesn't need to wear a hijab. We're not cutting my daughter's genitals off. So the Muslims need to just get straight facts here that I don't agree with what they're up to. And so they need to, you understand, I don't want to kill them. But I'm not going to roll over to what they're doing. And globalism is all about turning us over to Islam. Some deal's been made, and that's why I'm so against it.
I actually think that globalists are against the regular Muslim. They love the jihadis, and they're using the jihadis mostly against...
No, I agree. They use the jihadis as a pretext to invade all their countries and then stir them up further. That's like alien dialectic. We'll be back. Thank you, Tom. CJ, Jay, Dan, Charles, your calls are 3 minutes away. Stay with us. And yes, it is. I'm going to go right back to your phone calls here on this Tuesday worldwide broadcast, 29th day of November 2016. We have some of the biggest sales of the year. We have thousands of items, so a lot of sales are big. But this is one of the biggest. I don't want to say it's the biggest, but it may be the biggest. It's in the top two or three of the year. I quite frankly tried to look at it this morning and try to figure it out. It's the biggest ever. It's one of the biggest ever. Free shipping with promo code FREE. That's just for radio listeners who are actually tuning in to hear that. On top of 10% off when you sign up for auto ship or things that are obviously reordered like Supermel Vitality or non-GMO coffee or things like that. And we've got 30% off Supermel Vitality. That's our best seller right now. It's about to sell out, unfortunately, the next few days. More's coming in 2 weeks. And we've also Super Female Vitality. Anthroplex is the drier version of that. In my opinion, works just as good, but it's less price, just saying. We've also got extended specials on silver, Bullet Colloidal Silver, 50% off on that. That is unprecedented. We've got a lot of other specials, 30 to 40% off on survival food just today. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And it is your purchases of the products that fund this. We're supported by listeners and viewers like you. And these really are great products. I mean, I dumped a bunch of little silver when I had this allergy cold or whatever it is. It's decimated the whole city. It kicked out of my sinus down into my lungs, but we'll see what happens. These are really good products. Living Defense, Knockout, Anthroplex, Winter Sun, Liver Cleanse, Oxy Powder, Prostaguard. We've got the, speaking of that, that's really helped me at night. Let me do some of this. That's a lung cleanse. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or 888-253-3139. And then finally, some of our great third-party sponsors, the great folks. Chuck Undersea made an amazing film with General Jerry Boykin, former founder of Delta Force. Charlie Daniels is the narrator and host. J. Edward Griffin, Joel Skousen, myself, Alex Jones, and so many others. It covers a range of topics such as privacy, Gen 21, the Federal Reserve, nationalism versus globalism, and much more. Visit revelationthemovie.info, that's revelationthemovie.info, to purchase the DVD or check into hosting at a theater near you. revelationthemovie.info, a new film by Chuck Undersea. Check it out. And finally, Solutions from Science, pocket solar generator. It's amazing. It can run a lot of 110 appliances at your home, like a small refrigerator. It can also keep your food from spoiling. But the best part is you can also take it with you. It's mobile. You can also jumpstart cars, trucks, buses, 18-wheelers, huge tractors, airplanes, you name it. Get one for your truck, one for your car, one for your wife's car, maybe your daughter at college's car. You can buy one right now. Use the coupon code ALEX or Alex at checkout, and you'll get a second one free. The code name Alex. This is promo code. Plus a bunch of off-the-grid bonuses that are free, too. This is a great deal. Claim one today at privatepowergrid.com. That's privatepowergrid.com. But know this. When you support this broadcast, you're funding people that go to events and charge into communist nests. You're funding people completely turned over to fighting the New World Order. I mean, there's not one spot brighter in the fight against evil, and I don't say that in the power trip. I've learned I need to declare it. We're kicking their ass up one side and down the other, and I'm just so far beyond fear or anything now at this point. I'm like a robot. What
the hell was that?
Just fell over. It's really loud. All of this is going on, and thank you for your support. That's all I can say. So you can't lose. You buy these products, it's a donation to fund us. But I go out and neurotically, because it's not a compulsion. It's not a superstition. It's beyond that. I've said this before because it's how I live my life. I cannot promote something that I don't personally use and believe in. And a lot of times we'll have a product and I find something better, we drop it. I won't even keep it in the store. I'll drop it and bring in something new, something better. Nico, what was that? I wonder, it was really loud. Oh, the whole keyboard fell off. Thank you. I'm an idiot. Point is that that's actually normal. Tribal behavior. And they've drummed that out of us and then used what's left in our tribalism to fight with each other. We're all just humans under the same globalist attack in the technotronic era. So I want to thank you all for your support. I don't just say this is some cast aside deal. It's just as important to support our local FM and AM affiliates, to support them and to become a sponsor or to support their sponsors and let them know you're a sponsor or you support their sponsors, or to send $100 to the station. Our time has come, which means we're in the greatest danger ever because we're right on target. I could never get above 180 affiliates in 20 years on air. It was some magic number. There weren't a lot of independent stations. They would always put ESPN on once we got good ratings and take us off. They would always sell the station or change management. We hit 230 months ago. I haven't looked because I'm cutting liners every couple of days for new affiliates I've never heard of. I should probably have John Harmon up at GCN come on sometime. He like part-time does the affiliate stuff. The point is that we're not just getting mom and pops who are wonderful and who took us to the dance, so we're with them. We are on 50,000 waters in places like L.A., in New York and places. It's just crazy. It's crazy. And it's because the managers and the owners finally get this stuff sounded crazy. This guy's for real. Let's do it. Plus he gets ratings. Of course it sounds crazy. I cannot believe when I'm reading WikiLeaks about Obama wants $60,000 worth of hot dogs. Oh, I crave sucking hot dogs. Oh, don't worry. We'll have the packages, we'll have the children ready and prepared for you. They're going to submit quite nice. You're reading this stuff and you're like, this is certified WikiLeaks? What the hell, you know? And then Podesta's brother gets the Washington Post to pull out of their archive 2 days after we reported, where they're talking in an article about they love to photograph the neighbor kids naked. And so we've got an article out about them connected to pedophilia, reportedly. Hopefully not. And it's like, oh, God, you were in the Washington Post doing it. It's like, geez, I don't want to go up against a bunch of killers. But then I think about those kids, and I just go, you know what? Lock and load. You want to overturn the election? Have the globalists not learned that our own intelligence agencies expose you in triplicate? Do you really think you're going to pull off some more crap? The real thing about patriots is I don't want to say we're lazy. We're almost asleep. It's like we're like a barracuda just laying off, kind of asleep in the surf. And until something comes and bumps us in the nose, we don't do anything. So we're just kind of like, we just want to eat a hamburger and go hang out with our family, and we're not looking to dominate anybody. All of a sudden, here comes a pedophile by us, and we're like, what the hell is that? Well, you're hurting a kid. Okay, I got to start doing something. Then you kind of come intimidate us and get in our face and you do something nasty to us. You know all the stuff you do. And you're like, you know, I'm not like you. All you did messing with me is make me want to hurt you. And I'm going to hurt you real smart. I'm going to hurt you long. Not because I want to hurt you, but because God wants you to have some time while you're getting drugged down to the entrance to hell. Think about exactly which side you signed up for. And when you're about to go down that rat hole forever, I want you to look right into my eyes and remember you lost so that every other evil scumbag in the universe feels that spiritual tidal wave, that spiritual gravity, that if you want to hurt innocent creatures, sentient beings, you're going to have to pay the piper for something that hunts you. You think you're the top of the food chain hunting children? There's something else up there. Something always watching overhead, manifesting. All right, let's go to the phone calls. Jay in New York, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Mr. Jones, how are you? First of all, congratulations on making Forbes magazine cover. Well deserved, sir.
I think that was a joke thing online, but okay.
Was it now? Okay.
Well, you know how we made Forbes cover? We're rated online like 50 times bigger than them, so that's how we made the cover.
I believe it would be well deserved, sir. I've been calling many times, but actually as a different caller, actually with a British accent, and I'm sure you actually can distinguish that, sir. But what I have actually wanted to bring to you was Leviticus 26:9, because I see that you are quoting the Lord on many occasions. And Leviticus 26:9 says, "For I will have respect unto you and make you fruitful and multiply you and establish my covenant with you." Now, Leviticus 26:7 says just before that, now this really concerns you, Mr. Jones, "And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. 8, and 5 of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight, and your enemies shall fall before you by the sword." And I guess I'm calling because I'm asking for you to perhaps consider getting a little bit more aggressive. Like, I myself have called the FBI on many occasions and said, "Listen, when are you going to arrest that horrible woman?" Like, excuse me? I said, "When are you going to grab that woman by the hair, grab her off to a military prison, and hold her for trial, for proper trial?" You don't understand that by that Pizzagate, they're making us taxpayers pay for all of those evils, their spirit baths, spirit cookings, and all that stuff. They're making the U.S. taxpayers accessory to their murder. So therefore, anybody who's actually standing by her...
No, I agree. They do it and even have it come out. So if we don't do anything, we now become accessories and the country's judged. The devil is trying to lower our shields.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But to us, to we believers, us believers, Mr. Jones, and you're very much included, "No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord and their righteousness."
No, I agree with you. So what do I do?
Well, Mr. Trump is on the right quest. Anybody who doubts Mr. Trump, by the way, I've called Trump Towers many times, the campaign offices. Do you know that everyone that I've met there is actually a believer?
Yes.
Like, even without telling, I say, "You're a believer, aren't you?" Like, of course. And yet I've yet to find one believer in the Lord that is actually for Hillary. I'm sorry. But Revelations 20 does say, "And I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand." Now, who does that sound like? "And he lay hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. That's Mr. Trump with his announcement saying, "I'm going to drain that swamp." When I called the FBI, they said this. I said, "Who do I have to call?" They said, "Call Internal Affairs. Call the district attorney." I said, "Okay, call the district attorney." They said, "Call the State Department." I called the State Department 3 times. They hung up on me. By the 4th time, I said, "Listen, you hang up on me one more time, I'm going to the media." They said, "Go right ahead." And I said, "Now, how about this?"
Well, I think you've done it, Jay. I think you go to the media and the court of public opinion and you indict them. And just as the Bible says there's many forms of Antichrist before the Antichrist, I think there are many forms of Christ before Christ returns. And all of us, I think, are a manifestation of that. I think Trump is that. I don't want to say he's the archangel bringing the devil, you know, to hell and or locking him up for 1,000 years. But certainly biblical things are unfolding right now. And I want to thank you for your call. All right, who's up next? holding the longest is Dan. Yeah, I'm under the weather, folks. Really bad allergies. I can hardly breathe, but I'm here. I'm going to take a few days off just to get out of town, get away from this stuff. I can't even drive down the road. It's so bad. But it's not just me. It's everybody. And I was reading all over the country, everybody's really sick. So maybe it's viral. I don't know. But this is just, I've never experienced anything like it. I'm not bitching being on air. This is great to be on air. It's having a bed because that's even worse. Dan in Ohio, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, I to you back in October the 20th. After I disrupted Obama's rally in Cleveland, Ohio,
yes,
the Bill Clinton rape contest, what's going on with that? I understand I'm a winner, but I haven't heard anybody from that contact.
Well, here's the deal. I don't do a lot of contests because we half-ass them. It's nobody's fault. We've always paid out. I've had $100,000 contests we've paid out. One-time winners, $100,000. When they hit about 90,000, I told Don Salazar that was running the thing, I said, shut this down. We don't have the extra surplus. People are still doing it everywhere. We made the announcement then, stop it. But I remember you called in, and I think you got like a $1,000 winning or something like that. I don't remember the exact details, but I remember you calling in. And so this is not staged. This caller's not staged. Call Don Salazar in here. It's not his job. Poor guy's a writer. He just volunteered to do some of the contests. And then people kept doing it. We kept saying, stop, stop, stop. But you called in before I announced the $100,000 was spent when it was at like 90,000. So we'll make good on that. The big thing is the whole bureaucracy and getting it done. But I know, excuse me, that we have mailed out $100,000 so far. And look at the great effect. We got Donald Trump in office. It raised the whole hypocrisy. But let me have a coughing attack on you, Dan. Sorry. Don Salazar is now in place. Are you going to come in here? Yeah. Only because I don't have a mic up here. Just go stand up that microphone. Sorry. Yeah, you were there. Anyways, so I remember you. You were before the contest closed. I remember your voice. In fact, I think you're the guy that was behind Hillary and you got led down, right? Is that you?
Yeah. Well, no, I was the guy who was in front with standing on a piece of guardrail yelling at Obama, and he had to say, okay, son, stop. Why don't you go to your own route? I was that guy.
Sure. Well, we did that to expose him, and we want to pay off on it. And I'm going, I remember your voice, so I'm very good on voices. Don, your whole memory on this, because I want to pay all these out, but folks keep doing it even today. And I said like 2 months ago or a month ago, stop. Where are we, Don? You're running this.
I think all the winning participants have been paid out unless they've not reached us. So they can definitely email us at rape@infowars.com or just email me personally, adon@infowars.com, and I'll check the list to make sure they get paid out if they've followed all the contest rules
and sure,
properly.
Last time I talked to you a month, I said, I don't care if it goes a little bit over, but I got to cut this off or I'll go bankrupt. It was so successful. How much have we paid off? Does Lydia know?
Yes, I think it's close to 97,000 already.
All right, well, I remember, I don't know how I remember, but I remember this guy called in before the contest was over. So I don't remember if it was 1,000, 5,000, whatever he won. I want to make sure he wins that. So let's get his number now. I know it's not your job, Don. You just stepped up to the plate to do this contest. So when people say do contests, I got to have crew run contests. So we have limited crew to do this with this huge audience. But we will try to make sure that happens, Dan, because I remember your call.
I've been contacting Rob Dew, A-Leg, and A-Dan. And nobody has been talking to me. You know, it's been quiet. I know the election, you guys.
Well, sure. Well, let's just be clear, though. We've had probably 30 contests, and you've seen the folks on that have all won the contest. It's just, it's a bureaucracy to get all this done. So I'm going to put you on hold. And then, Don, let's get him on in like a week or so when he gets the check and gets it paid.
Okay.
Because I remember this guy was before. He's not BSing because he called like weeks before it ended. So let's get his number right. John Harmon, can you get his number? And then send it to Salazar so we can get him paid. All right, there you go. Yeah, no, but I did the contest just to make it fun. We've paid out $97,000. The taste of love is sweet. When hearts like ours meet. When hearts like ours meet. Paul Watson's taking over the next hour. I'm taking your phone calls right now. I was here looking at the story from Infowars.com. Report, Hillary planning in another run for president 2020. This woman is the definition of herpes. Paul Watson's going to be covering that. Stein sues to force recount by hand in Wisconsin. file suit for PA recount only in Republican areas where Trump won. I mean, this is naked BS. Unbelievable. Who's up next? Let's go to CJ in Rhode Island. You're on the air, my friend.
That's a pretty simple question. Are you sure Donald Trump's for real? Because, look, he's had a friendship with the Clintons. He's had phone calls with them before, you know, he ran for president. I just want to get your take on that.
You know, that's the question I ask myself every 10 seconds. My gut tells me Trump is for real. That's why the elite are so scared of him. I know he worked with the Clintons. He worked with everybody. He's called me repeatedly. I'm going to leave it at that. Let's just say repeatedly. Let's say I've missed some calls from Donald Trump like 10 times. Let's say I've missed 10 Donald Trump calls, at least. The media would piss themselves, you know, if they knew that was true, which it is. We'll see what he does once he gets in. You got this commitment. He goes sideways. I'm going after him. All I got is my integrity. But Hillary, we know who she was. So that's why we did what we did. But so far, I'm pretty pleased. What do you think?
Well, you know, the torture talk, the saying he's going to go after Iran, I really don't like that.
No, I hear you. I don't want war with Iran, but Iran aimed a missile again at a freaking helicopter. They got to stop doing that.
Exactly. Well, thank you, Mr. Jones. I really appreciate it.
I appreciate you. Listen. I cannot sell out. It's not in my DNA. I'm watching Trump like a hawk. And I'm not bragging, but I had Bush try to get me to go to hang out with him and stuff when he was president-elect. I don't care about a president. He's nothing to me. So don't worry. I'm not going to go off the reservation just because Trump's giving us attention. He's got the elite pissed for a reason. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt till he gets in. And if he delivers on just 30, 40%, I mean, Hillary was going to bring us to the next level of Supreme Court justices, gun bans, you name it. If he just makes things a little better for poor people and stuff and better trade deals, I'll say, well, he ain't perfect, but he ain't Hillary Clinton. I'm going to be a scorned woman. He screws us over, I'm going to go ape. So just, I'm not looking forward to that if I have to, but I'm just going to do what has to be done, okay? You don't have to worry about me. I'm not even my own person. I'm a slave to the truth. I mean, I am. I cannot help it. If I see somebody going sideways, I'm going to cover it. But I'm not going to just jump on the bandwagon right away. I don't see all the method, the madness yet. I'm seeing some good. I'm seeing some bad. I want to be cleared to fire when I pull the trigger. I want to know exactly what I'm dealing with. Now, I'm going to break and take a few more calls and hand the baton to Paul Watson. I'm not trying to talk like Charles Bronson right now. The worst allergies hit the United States have ever hit. I don't know what's going on with GMO or what's triggering it. Almost everybody I know is super sick. I feel like I got fire in some of my lungs, but I am here and I'm enjoying it. And don't think, oh, your son has to be on air while you're sick. This is a lot better than laying in bed. Because every time I cough, it's like an ice pick. I like separate a rib or something, so it's like ice pick time. So I am glad to be here on air. The adrenaline is awesome. Because the minute I get off air, it's going to be a lot more painful. Back in 70 seconds for the fourth hour. Some stations carry it, some don't. Spread the word, Infowars.com/show. They hate that link. They hate us. Spread the word, folks. They can't stand it. The new media defeats them. I wish you goodwill across time and space. Come in peace. Paul Watson's coming up in the next segment. I'm going to take a few calls before we do that. Paul's under the weather like I am right now. But, Paul, people keep asking, is Trump for real? That's kind of a Soros talking point. I'm not poo-pooing asking if he's for real, but what is your take on that?
Well, I mean, there's an overreaction on both sides, Alex. You look at the Mitt Romney situation. You know, if he selects Mitt Romney for his Secretary of State, the whole narrative has been about, oh, but what about the insults during the campaign? How can we possibly forgive Mitt Romney for his insults? It's not about his insults. It's about the fact that he wanted to arm jihadists. It's about the fact that he wants war with Russia. But again, you can't just immediately dispense with a year and a half of hard work because he makes one decision that you don't like. And, you know, leftists are all over the place saying that Trump's surrounding himself with people who believe the same thing as him. Well, he's not, is he? If he's picking Mitt Romney, then that is definitely diversity of opinion. So likewise, just because he does something positive with the wall or any other issue, TPP, we're not immediately going to bow down and worship him and unquestionably, you know, just follow him without thinking about any of his actions. So on either side of the equation, whatever he does, you can't dispense with it immediately because that's a massive overreaction. Unfortunately, you know, that's how a lot of people think. They think that because he does one thing they don't like, that that means he's betrayed the entire movement immediately. Well, just let him get into office at least. Let him have 100
No, I agree. What scares the elite so much about him? That's his biggest feather.
Yeah, exactly. And if you look at his contract with Americans, all of that he says can be established, can be accomplished within the first 100 days. Well, give him the chance to do it. You've got Obama on the flip side saying that he's going to sign a slew of executive orders over the next 6 weeks or so before he's out of office. So a lot of Trump's time initially will be caught up in rewinding, undoing all that.
That's right. They bitch at him for not signing.
Get into office in the first place.
They bitch at him for not signing.
Start hitting him, which we will do if he does betray everyone. But you can't just overreact on one thing that you don't like that he's done so far.
Well, I agree. He's in front of a mountain of work. They're like saying, you know, he better rewind everything or, oh, he's transitions in chaos. He won't sign documents Obama's sending over. We've now learned are documents never been sent before. They're trying to get Trump to sign contracts as a president to bind himself before it ever happens.
Exactly. And, you know, paralleling that, you've got this huge recount effort, which has basically got no chance of succeeding. It's not going to overturn the election results. But again, they're trying to put a roadblock between Trump and the inauguration, you know, January 1920, whatever day it is. They're trying to delegitimize his legacy before it even begins. And it's completely failing, as we predicted it would. Jill Stein basically didn't adhere to the law in Wisconsin, which said you need to have proof of fraud. It wasn't just, oh, you have to pay this bill. It's you need to have proof of fraud. Well, they completely let her override that. There's going to be a recount there. Whether it takes place in time or not, we don't know. But they're charging her three times the amount they initially suggested was required. So now she's asking for even more money. What a surprise. More
this is in between worshiping Fidel Castro.
Exactly. So Pennsylvania is looking bad as well. You've got to have people file affidavits in every single voting district. That's never going to happen. You're going to need at least three people in each district filing affidavits. But again, they're probably going to bend the rules to allow them to do it. That's what I said at the start. Watch for them bending the rules to allow this.
Let me ask you this question.
By the way, that deadline is passing in about an hour. So if they don't pay for Wisconsin, watch again for them bending the rules to allow this to go forward anyway.
I'm going to come back and turn this over to you, but I want to ask you the question when we return. With 52 days till his inauguration, what else will they try to pull? We'll be back. Stay with us. The globalists have bad will for you and your family. I'm not perfect, but I'm busting my ass to try to deliver freedom. I want to be your forever man. All right, we're going back to Paul Watson. Your phone calls, obviously, with Charles and others holding. We'll get to you when he can. But there is so much unfolding. There's so much happening. During the break, we had CNN on during the break in the control room. I'm not trying to talk with a deep voice tonight. I have a really bad sore throat from pollen, and half the city's in bed right now, so I'm sorry. I sound like Darth Vader. This is how I am. I probably shouldn't even be here on air, but it just feels better to be on air than like in some bed. And they had the district attorney on about, we still don't know a motive in the Somali attacking. And there it is. Victim describes attack at Ohio State University. And they're still saying they don't know the motive. He's a jihadi from North Africa, from Northeastern Africa. And this is what they're doing. And I just love the media. There was an article this morning saying fake news. Alex Jones says Muslims carried out Ohio shooting. It wasn't a shooting. It was a frickin' stabbing. And so there's this game that the elites play where they define mother and father. They define conspiracy theorists. They define real news versus non-news. Don't they get that they have no credibility? Don't they get they're now a joke? Let me ask Paul Watson this, and I got one more thing to do. I'm going to get out of here. Paul, I see the mainstream media doing stuff that only discredits them further. Or do you see some other angle here, or are they just crazy?
No, they're in an echo chamber, and they think that they control the narrative, they control reality, so they can make up their fake news and just pretend that it's real. What's interesting is that there's fake news which is pro and anti-Trump. Yes, there are fake news websites, we know that. But for example, there was a story yesterday which went viral that said Trump had already had 5,000 votes in Wisconsin taken away from him. Completely made up, completely fake news. They don't complain about that because it doesn't feed into their conspiracy theory about Vladimir Putin and the Kremlin controlling absolutely everything. And again, that's the key. They call us conspiracy theorists all day long. For the past, what, 6, 8, 10 months, they've peddled the most egregious conspiracy theory about Russian President Vladimir Putin controlling absolutely everything with no evidence whatsoever, yet they still continue to peddle.
And by the way, I wish Putin was running things. I've never heard from Putin. We have to actually talk every day and try to figure stuff out, actually do it. Paul, looking at this, we see the Democrats only intensifying the previous deceptions they've engaged in. You're a smart guy. Where do you see this going? I mean, how does this unfold now? Because if what they did made them lose the election, now they're only intensifying it. Where does that lead?
Well, the obvious danger, Alex, is that they've made everyone hysterical over the past 12 months. They've said that Trump is Hitler. He's got his hand on the nuclear code. He's going to destroy the world. That has radicalized actual crazies in the United States. Several assassination plots against Donald Trump. That's why they've got a no-fly zone over Trump Tower, that entire area. And we see this again yesterday after the attack in Ohio. What is the reaction after an Islamic terrorist? And by the way, ISIS has now claimed responsibility for that attack, while the media still says, oh, was it a Muslim? What was the motive? Well, what do you think was the motive? He said what the motive was in a Facebook post before he did it.
Exactly. That's what I mean. It's like crazy.
It's all laid out. But they responded not by questioning, well, what's the issue here? Do we have a problem with Islamic terrorism, given that this is the second high-profile attack by a Somali migrant just over the past few months alone? We had the, again, knife attack in the mall in Minnesota, Minneapolis. No, they're not asking questions. This was a gun-free zone. If it wasn't for the brave cop, more people would have been injured. People would have actually died. No, they're talking about the biggest issue after this being mean tweets made against Somali migrants. They've actually got a student out of Ohio State University in NPR, I'm going to cover this article later, saying that the biggest worry is, quote, snide comments and mean tweets about Somali migrants. Again, they're just...
Paul, let me interrupt you, then I'm going to get out of here, but you bring up too many points. We had an article yesterday on Infowars.com where the local Islamist mosque and group said, oh, white cop shoots Muslim. Oh, we see it's racist. They were saying that the cop wasn't a hero for shooting this guy. I mean, this is getting crazy. And then they have Democrats on TV. I have a clip here we're going to play in a minute, saying it's the fault of guns a day after it was admitted not to be a gun.
No, exactly. We've got other tweets like this one, which blamed Trump and white Americans because the terrorist was probably bullied by racists. And again, this would be a fringe thing unless it was being backed up by the media. So they're out legitimizing violence. We saw them legitimize violence against Trump supporters. Wave of violent physical beatings of Trump supporters off the country, across the country. Meanwhile, they're making up fake hate crimes against Muslims. We've documented that over and over again. And if you go out and you watch the videos where people talk to these Somali migrants in these communities who are completely unintegrated, you know, it's the biggest source for ISIS.
Now, they're like a 10-minute video. They almost all support jihad.
Yeah, we're going to play the video. They ask them directly, do you believe that violence is justified if someone makes fun of the Prophet Muhammad? They all say yes. They all say that violent terrorism is justified. But the problem, after someone goes on a knife rampage and slashes 9 innocent people, sure, is not that ideology.
Sure, and they're kicking Italians out of their own businesses to put Islamists in. I mean, why do you think the left is allied with radical Islam?
Because it gives them protection against all their arguments against anyone who disagrees with them. If you disagree with them on their arguments, they just run and hide behind racism and behind Islamophobia.
So in a sense, they're using it Islam as a human is like the muscle of the left now.
Yeah, they're using it as a human shield for their arguments, which on the you know, foundation of it completely collapsed, if they can use this as a shield, then it benefits them. I mean, you've got San Francisco today, Alex, coming out and passing a resolution saying we're a sanctuary city. By the way, Ohio State students called for their campus to be a sanctuary days before this attack. So San Francisco comes out and says we're a sanctuary city. We will allow basically illegal immigrants to live here. Meanwhile, we're also going to protect the LGBT community from all the hate that's coming their way. Well, the problem with that is most of the hate is coming from the illegal immigrants that you bring in. They asked Muslim immigrants in Britain if they think homosexuality should be legal. Over 50% of them said no. Homosexuals should basically be criminalized.
Well, that's so the thing about Fidel Castro. He gayed, he jailed gay activists. I mean, in China, yeah, they arrest you if you're gay. If you keep doing it, they kill you. And I tell leftists, they go, shut up, homophobe. I mean, it's like, I don't even care about all this stuff. It's like, why do they hate America so much that gave them all this freedom? Look, America's got problems. But everybody line up around the block like Kaepernick to bitch when they make $170 million. It's like, it becomes a joke, you know, Paul? It really becomes a joke.
It's a total joke. That's why they're losing their argument. The thing with Castro was he rounded up people who had like long hair or who wore their trousers.
Well, he's on record. He put, when he first got in 59-60, he arrested like 5,000 gay people in Havana.
Yeah, and a lot of them weren't even gay. They just had long hair.
You saw them as artists. Yeah, like any guy that didn't look manly, they arrested.
Yeah, and again, you know, they overthrew another regime which had black people in high positions of power. The top three positions of power were held by black people. Then black people were put in gulags. They were shot by firing squads, but the left worships Castro. Again, it makes absolutely no sense.
Well, it's like ISIS killing all the black Libyans. I mean, where are they supposed to live? It's not Africa. And again, the thing is, folks, we're not against Cubans. We're not saying they're all racist or something. The point is, we hear all day how the West is evil. We're going to skip this break and give Paul more time to go to your calls and cover more. Just briefly before I play this Tim Ryan Congressman clip, says college campuses should be insulated from guns. This is hours after, this was last night, after it was admitted to be a machete. They think you're so dumb, they're still saying it's guns. But before we go there, we are running the Black Friday special right through Cyber Monday, right through Cyber Tuesday. It will end today. Free shipping with promo code FREE. Nobody seems to be using that. It's a big deal, folks. Free shipping with promo code FREE at checkout. Sign up for auto ship, additional 10% off, 30% off Super Bell Vitality, 30% off X2 Survival Shield, 25% off BioPCA hair, nail, and skin formula. We've got 50% off colloidal silver. You cannot lose because your purchases is what funds a hardcore operation that is at the tip of the spear fighting the New World Order. But regardless, you're funding us. I thank you. I appreciate you. But you really should try Super Bell Vitality. That's our best seller, about to sell out. You should take advantage of everything. There's thousands of items. InfoWarsStore.com is the big main shopping mall. InfoWarsLife.com is the supplements. Made1776.com is the Made in America apparel, because we give you the choice of that or Made in Mexico or whatever. It's all there, InfoWarsStore.com. And thank you all, because that's how we're funding Paul and Steve Watson, his brother, who's a political scientist, and all the other writers and reporters. We want to hire another 10, 15 people in the next year and really go to the next level. And it's up to you to fund us. And by the way, you've been doing that. We're actually making our goals now, even though I'm not doing my job plugging. And so you're going to see major expansion in 2017, infinity and beyond. So, Paul, let me play this clip of the congressman. This is Tim Ryan. College campuses should be insulated from guns. I'm going to hand the baton to you, my friend. Thank you so much. Here's the clip.
Congressman, one more point before we get to your race, and that is that as soon as tomorrow, the Ohio Senate plans to vote on a bill that could possibly allow concealed handguns on college and university campuses. Do you think that's a good idea?
You know, I really don't. I think that, you know, college campuses and other areas need to be safe havens, and I get it. I understand the other side of the argument, but there are certain places that I think and need to be kind of insulated from guns, and I think places of education and higher learning are those places. But, you know, again, right, that's in the Ohio Senate's hands right now.
I got to come back. I said I was gone, but just because Tim Ryan, the Democrat, says make these free zones. You advertise them like a moth to flame for crazies to go stab people, run over them with cars, shoot people. It's not the car's fault. It's not the gun's fault. It's not the machete's fault or the buck knife's fault. It's the crazy jihadist or psychopath that you brought in that did it. That's who keeps doing it. But since we mentioned that, we actually have footage yesterday at Ohio State of what happened when the peace officer, who they're calling a racist white person, came up against the jihadist with his sword and what happened. Here it is. That's what I do almost every day politically. So there you go, folks. That's the reality of what happened. And Paul, they engage in these cover-ups not knowing everyone knew. I said hours before on air, I said, I bet it's a North African Somali because almost every stabbing has been Somalis in the U.S. In Europe, it's been so-called migrants to Syria, but that's mainly other jihadis. I mean, it's not hard to guess this stuff. Paul, take over.
Well, thanks, Alex. It's not hard to guess, you're right, because, again, we're going to play this clip where they go out and interview Somali migrants in Minnesota who say directly, yes, violent terrorism is justified if somebody makes fun of the Prophet Muhammad. This is what they believe. This is the religion of peace. It has nothing to do with gun-free zones. That's not going to stop it. We have to tackle...
And let's not forget, in the Netherlands, they're having a trial of the guy that's a front-runner for president, who mildly criticized Islam. In Europe, they're already banning free speech.
No, he said, he asked people if they wanted less Moroccans in the Netherlands. They said yes, and now he's up for hate crimes charges, which is interesting given that the vast majority of the migrant rapists who molested women in Cologne last New Year's Eve, by the way, they're paying for a huge police operation, vast, costly operation to try and stop
helicopters. Drones to stop the Muslims raping.
And most of them were Moroccan. I mean, it seems to be their particular speciality that they engage in this kind of behavior. And what's Germany's answer? Let's import hundreds of thousands more. And Angela Merkel is running now for, what, a fifth term? I mean, it's getting a bit ridiculous by now. But again, her popularity is in the toilet. You've got a situation in France where I went to Paris recently. It's an open-air migrant camp. You've got mattresses on the street. You've got people fighting with sticks on the street in good areas of Paris that were formerly tourist hotspots. They've lost tens of billions of dollars in tourist money. But again, the backlash is Le Pen. The backlash is coming across Europe. We're seeing it already. They're not going to have it all their own way. And we're going to continue now before the break with more news. Again, we're going to get back into this Ohio State University situation. They're now saying that mean tweets, that horrid glances by other students towards Somali migrant students, that is the primary threat after this rampage. Not the rampage itself, not nine people being slashed. No, that's not the problem. The mall attack before that, that's not the problem. The problem is mean tweets. And we're going to get into that now because we skipped the last break. Again, this is up on Infowars.com. You see it there. Media characterizes mean tweets as more dangerous than Islamic terror after Ohio attack. Now, this is NPR. The first thing NPR did was to go and talk to a Somali refugee at Ohio State University. And he said, quote, listen to this. Oh, and by the way, universities in the aftermath of this across America are sending out letters demanding people don't say mean things about Muslims. Because that's the main concern, isn't it? Not actual violent attacks against innocent people. They spoke to this Somali student, which is interesting because the guy who actually carried out the attack said in his social media post that he did so, and he was in the local student newspapers whining about Islamophobia and the mistreatment of Muslims. So what's the first thing they do after this? Whine about Islamophobia and the mistreatment of Muslims.
Well, exactly, Paul. I mean, look, Islamophobia, you don't like being cut up or being a slave or having your genitals cut off or having your country blown up. What's your problem?
But listen to what he said, Alex. This is NPR. When I first heard that he was Somali, I mean, my stomach did fall, not just because of what happened today, but because of what will happen tomorrow. So again, forget about the nine innocent people slashed, one critical in hospital. Something mean might be said to a Somali migrant in Ohio. That's the main problem. He went on to say, worrying about snide comments, peering eyes, and a feeling of uneasiness. He worried. He was dreadfully concerned about mean tweets, such as one that said, "Artan, the guy who carried out the attack, bit the hand that fed him." That was the tweet. So according to this Somali migrant student, that was the most painful aspect. Those are his words. The most painful aspect of this entire attack yesterday was somebody tweeting that the attacker bit the hand that fed him. He said that really shakes him to the core.
This is called Stockholm Syndrome.
Exactly. And we saw it after Brexit. We saw it after Trump. Again, they've contrived a bunch of fake hate crimes. Every time I'm on the show, I've got a list of like 5 new fake hate crimes that never happened. The police investigate them, say there's no evidence. The victim wasn't even at the place at the time they said this happened. Meanwhile, Trump supporters are getting beaten to a bloody pulp. Nobody gives a damn. The hate crime wave is against Trump supporters. But again, we see this. Be nice to the precious Muslims or they might attack you and kill you because it's a religion of peace. A good reaction to this, I thought, was from Bosch Forstin, who was probably remember the winner of the Draw Muhammad cartoon contest that was attacked in Garland, Texas, or they attempted to attack it. Responsible men with guns killed them. And Bosch Forstin said this. You can see it up on the screen. Muslims, the reason you're not getting the backlash you keep preemptively bitching about after Islamic attacks is because we're not like you. Again, that is the key. We're going to play this video after the next break where Amy Horowitz goes to these Somali migrant communities in Minneapolis and he asks them directly, would you rather live under American law or Sharia law? Every single one of them says Sharia law, says how great it is that they can force people into marriages, that they can cut off people's hands if they're accused of stealing. And then he asked them, well, what about people who make fun of, not even insult, make fun of the Prophet Muhammad? And the answer is again unanimous. Yes, people who strike out violently against those who insult the Prophet Muhammad or make fun of him, that's completely justifiable. That's reasonable. Violent terror attacks, justifying them. And this is Somali migrants living in America right now. So we wonder why the most ISIS fighters out of America are being shipped out of that very region. They're the ones straight out of those communities going to fight for ISIS in Syria.
All right. I am punching out for real now, but Paul Watson is on fire as usual. We'll be back after this quick break where he will take over the rest of the transmission and play these clips and more. But this is why you support the broadcast, is because we are the tip of the spear against the globalists. We have free shipping running right now with promo code FREE at checkout, InfoWarsStore.com. That means more reporters, more staff, more crew, and you get great products. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com takes you right to the supplements, or simply call toll-free, 888-253-3139. You can follow me on Twitter at Real Alex Jones. I haven't really gotten good at Twitter over the years. I'm trying to push it now. Paul Watson has a Twitter. It's one of the most successful out there online, routinely retweeted by Donald Trump, President Trump, and his sons as well. And Paul, as we go to break in 1 minute, plug some of your sites and things you're doing.
Well, yeah, you can find me on Twitter at Prison Planet. And again, that's grown so massively over the past couple of years. You know, like many others have on Twitter, I mean, that's one of the key reasons why Trump got in, was because conservatives became good at Twitter. That was a major detriment to conservatives, to Republican campaigns in general in the past, especially in 2012, that, you know, they just weren't active on social media. Now BBC News has got 27 million followers on Twitter. Routinely, our tweets get more retweets than BBC News, who have 27 million followers. That shows how much we're winning. We'll be back after this break on The Alex Jones Show Live. Don't go away. We are back live on the fourth hour of The Alex Jones Show. The deadline for the Wisconsin recount brought by the Green Party's Jill Stein is looming. The payment for it, at least, is looming, reports ABC News. The next deadline that has to be met in order for a vote recount to take place in Wisconsin is set for this afternoon. And this is basically going to happen within the next 2 hours, I believe, when the two third-party candidates who are pushing for the recount of the general election votes have to submit payment. And Jill Stein's got a little problem because they told her that the payment was about 3 times more than she initially thought. So she's going to have to ask a lot more suckers to give money to the Green Party for this fake recount that isn't even going to have any influence unless there's brazen outright fraud, which don't put it past them. So again, they've got until 4:30 p.m. today to make that payment in full. She's whining about it on Twitter, saying, yesterday we found out Wisconsin will charge us $3.5 million, an outrageous increase from the initial estimate of $1.1 million for recount 2016. So again, terrible, another opportunity for Jill Stein to milk idiots for more money. Again, if you look at Pennsylvania, where she's also exploring having a recount, despite the fact that Donald Trump won by about 77,000 votes, again, massive waste of money, they have to have individuals file affidavits, three within each voting district. And I believe that has to happen by tomorrow. I think that was the deadline, tomorrow. It's just not going to happen unless, again, they bend the rules. I said in the first video I made about this, she won't meet the requirements for this recount. She didn't in Pennsylvania because they said, not only do you need to pay for it, you need to have evidence of fraud. Well, both Jill Stein and the Clinton campaign, which has now glommed onto this, they were behind it from the very beginning, as we know. They had, and they admitted that they had no evidence of fraud. So they didn't meet that requirement in Wisconsin state law to have a recount, yet it's going ahead anyway. So again, they're bending the rules at every opportunity to make this go forward. And it's kind of ironic that this is out of Zero Hedge. Hillary lawyer calls on North Carolina GOP governor to stop recount despite tighter race than Wisconsin. So this is Hillary's lawyer, Mark Elias, who again became embroiled in this recount campaign with Jill Stein, calling on the GOP governor in North Carolina to basically concede the race, even though the margin of victory, 9,133 votes, is significantly less than the margin of victory between Trump and Hillary in Wisconsin, which was 22,800 votes. So again, less than half the margin of victory, yet the same guy who is overseeing this recount is calling for the governor to concede when he's overseeing a recount of a vote margin more than double that. Complete hypocrisy once again. Fox News reports Jill Stein's recount effort gets 12 times more coverage from ABC, CBS, NBC than her entire campaign. When Jill Stein was the Green Party's candidate for US president, the broadcast networks only gave her 36 seconds of coverage. However, as soon as she launched a campaign to contest the presidential election and demand a recount of ballots in several key states, the evening news shows on ABC, CBS, and NBC managed to find 7 minutes and 26 seconds of coverage for her in just 4 days. So again, she was on Anderson Cooper last night. She's been on every mainstream network pushing this because they're all behind it. Not because they genuinely believe, or you would at least hope so. In fact, there is a Guardian article where they're begging, saying, this is the last chance to stop a disaster. They actually think they're going to overturn a Democratic election, which will come at the cost of a civil war in the United States, but never mind that. They know it's probably not going to change anything, but what they want to do is delegitimize Trump before he even gets into office. Because again, even if he doesn't meet the electoral vote total, he'll still have more than Hillary, and then it will probably go to Congress to decide to pick the president. Congress is controlled by Republicans, so is the Senate. Obviously, they're going to pick Trump. But again, if they force them to do that, or even if they force just some of these electoral committee members, many of whom have received death threats from tolerant liberals, even if they just force some of them to back down, or even if they just take away one of these states from Donald Trump, again, it will dilute his political mandate. They're desperate at this point, so that's why they're going with this. Again, could it go further? Could they say, oh, we found this mysterious evidence of Russian hacking, which they created in the first place, and then use that to say, well, this election has been cast completely in doubt. Maybe we're going to have to do it all over again. Don't put it past them. 5-6 months after Brexit, nothing whatsoever has happened because of that. because the corrupt political class have come back in and basically annulled the democratic will of the British people, or at least they're trying to. So again, that's still a long shot, but it's there in the background. This is up on Infowars.com. Report: Hillary planning yet another run for president in 2020. Now, she is going to be 73 years old by the time of the next election. This again goes to the heart of the fact. This is a sociopath who is driven mad by her own insatiable lust for power to the detriment of her own health. Is she even going to still be mobile in 4 years' time? But they're saying that all these, oh, just spontaneous random viral selfie pictures where she appears in the woods with her supporters, who turn out to be her former campaign employees, they're saying that that is a setup to try and reconnect her with the American people, that she's just an ordinary person, you know, to hide the reality that she's a complete sociopath with a complete inability to have any kind of proper human emotion. That's what they're saying this is part of. Again, Ron Fournier, National Journal columnist, says that Jill Stein's widely derided recount is all part of that same agenda. He says, quote, it's about raising doubts about legitimacy of the election, even without overturning the result, and is part of Clinton's plans to keep her options open for 2020. So you've got that, you've got the random selfies. Sonny Bunch, editor of the Washington Free Beacon, tweets, this is also why she's randomly appeared with so many Dem operatives, PR flacks, in grocery stores and on hiking trails recently, because again, it's about trying to reconnect her with ordinary American voters. But a 73-year-old ailing, power-mad, obsessed, sociopathic Hillary Clinton apparently, reportedly, is still keeping her options open for 2020. So the Democrats have already destroyed their brand, and a lot of them still don't get it. They're not listening to Bernie Sanders, who said that identity politics doesn't work and that they should stop doing that. Many of them still believe that that's the way to go. So they may continue to shoot themselves in the foot. Let's get back to the Ohio State attack. Of course, this knife rampage yesterday. I mentioned earlier, NPR, the primary concern after a Muslim terrorist attack where 9 innocent people are slashed, 1 seriously in hospital. Primary concern is not the root ideology that has caused these attacks over and over again, including 2 by Somali migrants just in the past few months alone. Of course, we had the Minneapolis mall attack. No, that's not the main concern. The main concern is not about protecting American students on campuses. The main concern is that somebody might say something mean on Twitter. Oh yes, they actually give a platform to a Somali student migrant who says that his main source of trepidation is mean tweets, peering eyes, and snide comments. God forbid he might feel a little uneasy. That's the main concern after this horrific attack. We see this every single time. And what should be the main concern? Should the main concern be an ideology, which is embraced by many of these Somali migrants, which says that violent terrorist attacks are a justifiable measure if somebody makes fun of the Prophet Muhammad? In fact, let's go to this video now. This is video maker Amy Horowitz. He visits Minneapolis to talk to Somali migrants to get their attitudes about living in America, about Sharia law, about Islam on the record. This is what he found. Let's go to the clip.
This is the Cedar Riverside neighborhood of Minneapolis. It's known for the University of Minnesota, phenomenal ethnic food, and the export of American fighters to the terrorist groups ISIS and Al-Shabaab. In fact, it's reported that dozens of young Muslims from this community have gone to fight for these organizations. So we hit the street to find out what is going on. Is it easy to be Muslim in America? Or is it hard?
It's easy to be Muslim.
It's easy to be Muslim.
Yeah.
Nobody gives you problems.
No, it's no problem.
And you go to school here, obviously.
Yeah.
And the kids, are they good to you? Are they nice to you? Is it tough?
Oh yeah. It's not tough.
It's not tough at all.
No.
This is a free country. That's the beauty of it. So we love America. I mean, you know, it's a great country. Freedom of speech, freedom of choice of your religion.
Right.
So we don't have any issues.
Do you feel more comfortable living under American law, or do you feel more comfortable living under Sharia law?
Sharia law.
I'm a Muslim. I prefer Sharia law.
Right. Sharia law, yes.
You prefer Sharia law over American law?
Of course, yeah. Of course, yeah.
And do you find most of your friends feel the same way?
Yeah, of course. If you're Muslim, yeah.
Sharia law, it says if you steal something, they cut off your hand. So basically, they can leave their stores open. Nobody's going to steal anything because the Sharia is so tight. Usually, they don't do anything. The smallest things usually have big consequences.
And he can make his daughter marry somebody.
Yeah, he can. Yeah, he can. He has the authority, you know?
The authority to that.
Yeah, to do that. Yeah.
So here, how young do you think it's okay?
15.
How do you feel when this whole controversy with the Prophet Muhammad and people depicting the Prophet in cartoons, how does the whole thing make you feel?
That really pisses me off, you know what I mean? Because they know it's a button to push.
That makes me angry. And it's just that everyone gets, like, the big freedom. And then they don't see that the freedom that they're getting is causing a problem. It's causing hatred for other people.
Would it be better if we made it illegal in America to make fun of the Prophet Muhammad?
Definitely, yeah.
Do you think we should make a law that makes it illegal to...
That would be better, yeah. That would be better, yeah. To stop, you know, yeah. Aggression.
I was so upset and I was so mad. They insulted our religion, they insulted our prophet, and we couldn't take it.
And they shouldn't be allowed to do that?
Oh, my God. Big time, yes.
Do you understand the motivation behind the people then who strike out violently against people who depict the Prophet Muhammad?
Yeah, I understand totally where they're coming from, yeah.
Do you understand why they feel motivated to do that?
Yes, because when you every day face frustration and, you know, every day you have, you know, you're mad or somebody say that or you feel hate yourself, you can do anything you want. You if you commit suicide, you don't care because your heart is telling you, I don't want to live no more because you couldn't take that much hate or you kill someone.
In a way, they kind of deserved it.
Yeah, no, every action has a consequence.
Is it right to kill somebody who insults Muhammad?
Yeah, because she is just, she hates the religion, I understand, but she shouldn't pick up the prophet, you know?
So you understand why people would want to attack her?
Yeah.
If you had a choice, would you rather live here or would you rather live in the Muslim country?
I'd rather live in a Muslim country with my people.
Would you prefer to live in America or prefer to live in Somalia?
For me, I think it's Somalia.
Yeah. You'd prefer to live in Saudi Arabia?
Yeah.
Would you rather live in America or live in Somalia?
I would rather live in Somalia.
I'm not Americanized. I just speak fluent and I'm, you know what I mean? I'm articulate and I can articulate what I'm trying to say, you know what I mean? That's about it. But other than that, I mean, as far as my culture and my preferences and everything, it's still Somali, you know what I mean?
Even though here you have all the freedom and stuff like that?
And even though I have all the freedom.
Do you think life might be better in Somalia than here?
Because now you have the freedom of it, of practicing your religion,
right,
while working and doing your other things.
So again, they would rather move back to a Muslim country. They'd rather move back to Somalia than stay in America. Yet, surprisingly enough, none of them have. Could that just be because Somalia is a complete crap hole ruled by bloodthirsty warlords? I wonder. But again, you heard them in that clip. It's justified to attack and kill people who make fun of the Prophet Muhammad, which is exactly the screed that this Ohio State University attacker made before his knife rampage. Again, he said that Muslims were being mistreated, that Islamophobia was rampant, and that's what justified his attack. So then the NPR article that I cited earlier, they react by going out and talking to a Somali migrant who basically says the same thing, that Muslims are being mistreated, there's this huge Islamophobic wave, and the violence is justified, the violence is understandable. Another aspect to this is President Obama. Again, you had this hero shoot a terrorist dead, putting his own life at risk. Where's his honor from Barack Obama? This is a president who honored Clock Boy. Okay? 400,000 retweets on President Obama honoring Clock Boy, who, again, was a dreadful victim of Islamophobia because he brought a device into school that looked like a bomb and was then castigated for bringing a device into school because, of course, it didn't look anything like a bomb. Well, yes, it actually looked like a bomb. That wasn't Islamophobia. It was common sense. He became a cause celebrity. Barack Obama honored him officially. Barack Obama has nothing whatsoever to say about the hero cop who shot dead a terrorist and undoubtedly saved people's lives. What you're also not hearing in the aftermath of this is the fact that Donald Trump was right once again. 3 weeks ago, he said that Somali migrants in states such as Minnesota, that's where the individuals you just heard there, that's where they're from, he said that they refused to integrate and that a portion of them posed a terror threat. Quote, some of them are joining ISIS and spreading their extremist views all over our country and all over the world. Again, he told residents of Minnesota they were flooding in without your support or approval, citing the threat posed by these Somali migrants who have been self-radicalized, as happened in the case of Abdul Razak Ali Artman, the Ohio State knife man. Again, under President Obama, 43,000 Somali refugees have been settled in the U.S. with no adequate way to check their backgrounds as they enter the country. What's interesting about that is that more Somali migrants came to the U.S. under Bush than they did Obama, because it was the Republican-led Congress that oversaw the wide-scale importation of them. So again, the fallout continues. We've now got American Mirror reporting Ohio State students demanded sanctuary campus days before attack. They demanded that Ohio State University be a sanctuary for Somali migrants days before a Somali migrant went on a knife rampage. We'll be back with the final segment after the break. Breaking news at Infowars.com. Don't go away. We're back live for the final segment of the Alex Jones Show. Before I hit on a few final headlines, I want to direct you to InfoWarsStore.com, where we have Super Male Vitality at 30% off for this extended Cyber Monday free speech special. 30% off Super Male Vitality. InfoWars and other liberty groups are now being targeted by mainstream media controls and Soros-funded attack dogs who are trying to shut down free speech. And that's not a cliche. They're putting out fake news lists saying we're funded, controlled by the Kremlin, and that people should install extensions onto their browsers which pop up and say that we're fake news and that we can't be trusted. Of course, they're the experts at fake news. They blazed the trail for fake news with all their fake narratives and fake stories, and now they're targeting us for elimination, Google de-indexing, Facebook, Twitter censorship. This is why we need your support, by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. We're not just saying that. We've got to this position with your help, not with the help of George Soros, not with the help of giant corporations, not with the help of corrupt dictatorships in the Middle East like Bahrain, who pay CNN to do puff pieces for them. We're not backed by any of that. We're backed by you getting the products, and Super Male Vitality has hundreds of five-star reviews on InfoWarsLife.com, which you can read for yourself. Again, go and see the benefits this has had for other people. Check out the other products. We have Brain Force Plus. We have the extended Black Friday preparedness sale, 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food. The elite are preparing for this. They're all buying underground bunkers. The government has storable food. But if you buy storable food, you're a dangerous kook. Well, no, you're not. You're being perfectly reasonable. And if nothing happens, just eat the food. And you save money anyway. So again, that is InfoWars Select Storable Food at InfoWarsStore.com. 30 to 40% off, shelf life of 25 years. Nothing happens after 25 years. Just eat the food. It's a great insurance policy, and it supports the growth of this network. InfoWarsStore.com. Let's get to some final news stories. Cologne plans helicopters and mounted police to prevent mass sex assaults on New Year's Eve. Of course, last year we had the mass molestation of women by Muslim migrants, hush, hush, which the media refused to report on for 3 days. The police covered it up. Feminists blamed German men. So now they're having this huge security operation, probably going to cost millions and millions of euros of taxpayers' money just to prevent women from being molested as they walk in the streets of their own cities because Islam is a religion of peace. Lily Allen won't say if she's taken a refugee into her home as promised a month ago. Well, imagine my shock. In fact, you had Bob Geldof in September of 2015, over a year ago, say that he would take in Syrian refugee families. How many Syrian refugee families have been taken in to Geldof's numerous mansions? Zero. Because it's all about virtue signaling. It's not about actually doing anything to solve the problem. So again, Lily Allen, who goes to migrant camps and just cries on camera for public relations stunts, promised to take in Syrian refugees. What a surprise, hasn't done so. The Sun reports women's health at risk because scientists are terrified of being labeled sexist. Top academics have said the trendy belief that men and women's brains are the same is totally false. Again, that's a hate crime now to even say that. And is hampering the development of drugs. So they're now actually trying to develop life-saving drugs that in some cases only apply to women or men, but can't do that because if they come out and admit the thought crime, that God forbid there are some differences between men and women, biologically, then they may be fired. They fear being called sexist, another absolutely blazing example of the fact that feminism is a threat to women. That's going to wrap it up for the Alex Jones Show. Breaking news at Infowars.com. Thanks for joining us.